body ready, dear. Oh, we must be sure there's no turning back once we're out the door. Leave your message here on the telephone, 'cause we've no idea when we're coming home.
Hello and welcome to the Citroën Bay Crits. Matthew Keenan with you, joined by the former winner of this race, Gracie Elvin. Yesterday, Gracie, stage one in Geelong. Stage two today, also in Geelong in the Eastern Gardens. And yesterday in the women's race, Ruby Rose Manganon, pre-race favourite, defending champion. She delivered. She looked like she won that comfortably.
She didn't just win it comfortably. She tried to attack solo earlier in the race and had a number of attacks alongside her Bayside Citroën teammates. They made it a very aggressive race, very exciting. But the other teams were matching their strength as well, but they just couldn't quite overcome the class that we're seeing from Ruby Rose Manganon. And so early in the season, it's a great way to start 2023.
And you're right about that team. In particular, we saw Lizzie Stannard. She was consistently on the attack. We saw the breakaway go. Danny DeFrancesco, the winner of this year's National Road Series. It was good to see her in the thick of the action. Keely Bennett, she was second in the first two of the intermediate sprints. So she wears the green jersey for the Mitchelton sprint classification. But this sprint win by Ruby Rose Manganon, it was her and Daylight behind.
It was a fantastic lead out too by Matilda Reynolds and Georgia Baker. They set her up into a perfect position, and Ruby just saw that gap where she took it right in that last corner. She was so happy with the win, but she was very gracious in her speech after the race and congratulating all of her teammates and all of the work that they'd done as well for her.
And I think putting a smile on everybody's face behind her was Amanda Spratt finishing in second spot. We then saw the men's race a little bit later on. That's coming up after the women's race today. And yesterday in the men's race, it was Brenton Jones who managed to get the win. A look across the shoulder, the lead out from Blake Quick. Quick, the first to celebrate. Jones with a convincing win as well, like Ruby.
I love the post up from Blake Quick before Brenton had even crossed the finish line. But we were feeling the emotion back in the studio for the Jones family. It wasn't just a fairy tale finish for Brenton, having such great history at the Bay Crits, but also his mother and the rest of his family that spend so much time on this event. So we're hoping that he can hold that yellow jersey all the way to the end.
And there's another Jones generation coming, because Brenton's nephew, Archer, just 3 years of age, his brother Jared's son, was there as well and asking, why can't I race with Uncle B? And Grandma, Karen Jones, had to say, they might be going a little bit too quick for you, but I can keep up with Uncle B. We're not too far away from making a start in the women's race. Just like yesterday, it's 50 minutes plus three laps, three intermediate sprints along the way. The weather conditions are a little better than what they were yesterday. Still warm, but it's mid-20s as opposed to mid-30s.
Yeah, I heard from some of the riders yesterday how much the heat was affecting the race. Some of them were just dying really quickly. After one or two attacks, they were just straight into the red zone. And some of them are just not quite used to the heat yet, just not training, or they've come from Europe even, and they're just getting, you know, thrown into that deep end. So I think that they're very happy that it's a slightly cooler day today, but I think the heat will still play a role today, and potentially the wind as well.
And one of the people, Dan, they're coping with the heat is a guy who's won this series as well in the past, David McKenzie. He's going to take us through the course.
Day two of the Citroën Bay Criterium Series here in Geelong. Well, can you feel it? Can you see it? The wind is up. The temperature's dropped ever so slightly. It's still warm, but it's quite gusty. Same circuit as yesterday, but opposite direction. That will change everything today. The tight corner, the last corner, it's just a short run to the line. Ruby Rose Manganon, she was dominant yesterday. But what about Amanda Spratt in her new Trek Segafredo colours? She had the sprinter's legs on. Can she turn the tables today? We'll find out. Brenton Jones, he was dominant as well. He won by a couple of lengths in the end. What a fairy tale retirement race it should be and will be for him, no matter what happens moving forward. Blake Quick, he was somewhere thereabouts as the defending champion. It's all to play for here today.
Gracie, the same course, but a different direction. It's amazing how different the course can actually perform or ride going the opposite way around.
That's right. We saw this happen last year as well, the reverse direction of this course. I've never raced it this way before, so I can't really say what it's like, but we got to watch them this time last year racing on this direction. And it's that tight, tricky corner all the way up into the finish line that is very decisive and hard to get right. So I think it's those riders that have done plenty of practice laps in this direction this morning when they've been, had an open course and had that opportunity to have a look at it. But I think it is even trickier of a finish than yesterday's direction. So I think that a lot of riders are going to, you know, struggle a little bit with that tight left-hand corner going up into the finish line.
Well, they're underway, so it's 50 minutes plus three laps. There's 3 minute sprints along the way. They're generally after 15 minutes or so. Green jersey, you can spot there in the peloton. That's Keely Bennett, who leads that classification. She's riding for Team Bridge Lane, a new team on the circuit for women's racing. She's been around in men's racing for a long, long time. I'm sure we'll see Keely Bennett look for a potential early breakaway to pick up more points in the same manner in which she did yesterday.
The green jersey is about consistency as much as it is about good sprinting ability. So I think she just needs to keep up picking up points every opportunity she can. You don't have to win it every time, but just picking up one or two points can really make that difference to the overall category of the sprinter's jersey. It's such a nice thing to be able to wear a leader's jersey in a competition. So I think she'll be very proud wearing that green jersey today.
So who will be the first to attack? It didn't take long yesterday. So they're now making a left-hand turn. Yesterday, this was a right-hand turn coming up the hill. So this way on the course, the descending is shorter, steeper, and as they make their way back up to the finish line, it's a longer, more consistent drag to get there.
That's right. It does depend a bit on the
conditions as well on this lower straight. So yesterday they had a bit of a headwind going in the opposite direction, and that was making it quite difficult for attacks to go on this bottom end of the course. Today they're going to have maybe a bit more of a tailwind. We need to get a bit better picture of some of the flags so we can see what the wind is doing. But if they do have another tailwind, it just means the pace is a lot higher, and that also makes it quite difficult for attacks to get away. But you're right, it does drag a little bit up from about here on the course before it really kicks up into that tight left corner going into the finish line.
And from what we've seen from the earlier races, there's been under 13 races, under 15s, under 17s, plus the Masters. There's a slight cross tailwind along this section, which can make it more challenging in many respects if you lose contact with the rider that's just in front of you. Ironically, in a bunch race like this, a blockhead win makes it easier if you're struggling a little bit because you get more of an advantage sitting behind somebody.
That's exactly right, Matt. Having a tailwind, if you've been dropped, makes it so much harder to get back onto the bunch because you have to ride so much quicker to get back towards a very fast-moving bunch. So having a headwind can be advantageous if you're struggling a little bit. You can really hide in the wheels, whereas if it's a tailwind and it starts stretching out and that pace is very high, it's really difficult to get any rest. And now we can see them taking this tight left turn, I should say, for the first time. They don't seem to be struggling with it too much as they're all bunched up still at the moment. But I think once the pace starts to heat up, it'll be quite interesting to see what kind of lines they like to take on that corner.
Well, that's the sort of corner that the fatigue will build. And there's a real advantage of being towards the front of the race. They've done one lap. It's taken a little bit over 3 minutes. Those lap times will come down, I assume, to around about 2 minutes and 45 seconds as they start to build momentum, as they get a rolling start through that start-finish line now each time. But at the back of the race, you slow down a lot more through that corner.
There's a bit of a concertina effect, as we say. If you're quite way down in the peloton, you end up stopping and starting quite a lot more as that kind of ripple effect happens through the peloton. So you don't want to be down the back too much in a race with a lot of corners, because it means you're going to have to sprint out of the corners a lot harder and faster than some of those riders at the front. And if the riders at the front want to make it hard and they are sprinting out of the corners, it's even harder at the back. But everyone's taking it quite easy at the moment. I think after yesterday, seeing that aggressive style of racing from the Bayside Citroën team, I think the whole peloton's waiting for them to light it up again today.
Ruby Rose Bengannon going out the winner yesterday from that team. Second position was Amanda Spratt. Third was Peter Mullins. There are points for the top 10 riders across the finish line. So the current point standings, it's Ruby Rose-Manganon on 12 points, Amanda Spratt on 10, Peter Mullins on 8, Lucy Stewart, one of the young rising stars, her first season out of the juniors, she's on 7 points, Georgia Baker on 6, Alicia Wells racing here as an independent. No, she's part of the ARA Skip Capital team, so she's part of that team. She was 6, she's on 5 points, Chloe Hosking on 4 points, Matilda Reynolds on 3, Danny DeFrancesco on 2 points, and rounding out the top 10, Tilly Field from Rock Salt Liv Schramm, who we've seen a little bit of Tilly Field already in this race, sitting at the back of the peloton. She's not wearing a number today. It might have fallen off in the warm-up, but she rode fairly well yesterday, finishing in 10th. And that team, the Rock Salt Liv Schramm team, they were strong enough to have 3 riders inside the top 10. So they've been consistent. And then in the team's classification, they sit in 2nd spot in that competition behind Bayside Citroën. There is the race leader, Ruby Rose-Manganon. And at number 26 in the green jersey, the Mitchelton green jersey for the points classification, that's Keely Bennett. There are 3-in-a-minute sprints. It's 3 points for a win in each of those sprints, 2 and 1 for the minor placings. Keely sits on 4 points. Ruby Rose-Manganon is in 2nd position on 3 points. Also on 3 points, Ella Bloor and Lizzie Stannard is also on 3 points. So you could say it's a tenuous lead for Keely Bennett in the race for green.
I'd say a few riders think, oh, well, I'm up in the point standings for the green jersey. All I need to do is get a couple of extra points over riders like Keely Bennett to then get into the green jersey. And we've got 3 days of racing, so someone else might want to take over that jersey for tomorrow and take it out overall. We can see Lizzie Stannard on the front. She's on that very bright yellow bike from her team from last year. That's an easy way to pick out riders. You know what their bikes look like or their helmets. She's setting a high pace. I think they're maybe trying to set up an attack from one of the other Bayside Citroën team riders. But it's interesting to see the pace setting so high and such early in this race.
Well, she was impressive yesterday. If we did have a most combative prize yesterday, it certainly would have gone to Lizzie Stannard. She was consistently on the attack. There were quite a few breakaways, but we saw a lot of her at the front forcing the issue. And the team, their strategy quite clearly, Bayside Citroën, they're backing their sprinter, but also they're backing their strength. They want to make the race really hard, and it gives them more chance of controlling things at the back end of the race. And the pressure is already on, Gracie. You can see a few splits starting to appear in the field because of the pressure being applied by Lizzie Stannard.
I think that we saw that the concertina effect happening in one of those corners there. All it takes is for one rider to drop the wheel, and everyone in the behind that rider is really struggling to then have to overcome that and make the gap up. So you don't want to be sitting too far in the back of the bunch. It might be nice and restful. Say you're a sprinter and you don't want to be mixing in the front too much. There is that danger that you're going to get caught behind a split, and some of the favourite riders will be in the front, and you're going to have to put in a big effort to try and get back across. But we're seeing that gap being closed pretty quickly again. But I find this tactic coming from the Bayside Citroën team quite interesting. We can see an attack now. It looks like Lizzie Stannard on that bright yellow bike being followed by an ARA rider by the look of it.
It could have just about put a blindfold on and given you the guess as to who's going on the attack now, and they're in the white colours of Bayside Citroën. It was a fair chance it was going to be Lizzie Stannard. The yellow jersey, Ruby Rose-Manganon, staying nice and close to the front. Bike Exchange was the main team sponsor for last year. This year, it's Jayco, who is the number one sponsor. And Jayco have been a huge part of Australian cycling since first funding and supporting Cathy Watt in her campaign for the Olympics back in Barcelona in 1992. And then Cathy was the first winner of the women's edition of the Bay Crits back in 1994. So Jayco has been associated with cycling at the elite level for a long, long time.
Gerry Ryan has been a huge benefactor for Australian cycling for many years, especially under the name of Jayco, being such a big naming sponsor for so many riders, teams and events. Not only in cycling do you see Jayco, you see it in many sports across Victoria. Gerry Ryan and the Jayco brand have been such huge contributors to sport in general. We're very lucky to have them involved in cycling.
And sponsoring the Dandenong basketball team in the WNBL, they've managed to pick up Lauren Jackson. Not a bad recruit.
That's quite a good coup, isn't it? I wouldn't mind having her on the team.
There's the opposite stature to Lauren Jackson. Amanda Spratt in the Trek Segafredo colours riding towards the front. Here she's riding for Novotel Prestige Jayco. She was 2nd yesterday, and Spratty 2nd in a sprint finish. It's not her forte. That speaks volumes to a really good start for Spratty.
That's right. It was so exciting to see her sprint. She almost won. I think she thought she might have went one as well, but I can see another attack going now. It looked like a white jersey. It could be another Bayside Citroën rider going on the attack. I'd say they won a really tough, aggressive race. Ruby said in her interview yesterday that no other teams were as interested in getting a good breakaway going. So I think that they just want to keep humbling them, Matt.
It looked like Darcy Richards that time who was going on the attack. She wants to join the party as well of trying to get off the front. They've been racing now for almost 10 minutes. They'll get a whistle after around about 13 minutes or so of racing for the first of the intermediate sprints. So perhaps even the next time through the start-finish line, they'll get the whistle with one lap to go on the sprint. We'll wait and see. It could be two laps away, or maybe it's the next one through. A little bit at the discretion of the race commissaires as well as to when they blow that whistle.
Yeah, sometimes you think for sure it's going to be the next lap and they don't give the whistle, so it can be a bit disappointing. That was a great example a few moments ago of a counter-attack going there. Can't quite see who that was, but the best way to get a good breakaway going is to do those counter-attacks almost immediately after a breakaway has been caught back. You want to wait for that very split second of the lull and try and draw out another few riders with you. She would look like she was away solo. You want another few friends. And we can see the yellow jersey wearer now, Ruby Roseman Gannon, going hard on the attack with none other than Chloe Hosking on her wheel. Chloe, I think, would have been disappointed with her result yesterday. She is here to win bike races, not just participate. She's without a contract this year. She's been one of Australia's and the world's best sprinters for many years now. So it's very disappointing that she doesn't have a contract to get back to Europe this year. And that's why these Australian races are even more important for her to do well at.
There she is sitting in second position, Chloe Hosking behind the yellow jersey of Ruby Roseman Gannon. Emily Watts now comes to the front, another one of the rising stars of Australian cycling. Emily Watts in this race riding as part of Team Bridge Lane. Another attack going. It is the Bayside Citroën team once again. They're on the charge. They are really doing everything they can to make this race super aggressive. It's Georgia Baker this time through, the triple gold medalist from the Commonwealth Games of last year. This is a tough, tough start.
It was Emily Watts that was straight on the wheel of Georgia Baker. Emily's riding for Team Bridge Lane, which is a new women's team for this year. Team Bridge Lane has had a men's team for many years, more than a decade, I think. But this year that they also have a women's team, and many of these riders have come across from the Inform TMX Make team that had folded at the end of last year. Emily Watts is certainly a rider to watch in this series of racing in the summer of cycling coming up. She did very well last summer, winning a stage at the Tour Down, the Santos Festival of Cycling, which we sometimes like to say Tour Down Under. It will be Tour Down Under this year. But she is a great sprinter as well as a good time trialist. So a combination like Emily Watts and Georgia Baker is extremely dangerous to have off the front.
Now that stage victory that she had last year, she combined her time trialing and sprinting ability together because it was a long, hard sprint. She got the timing just right and she upstaged some of the bigger names of Australian cycling, a real sign of just how good Emily Watts is. That move, it's been responded to, though, by the entire peloton. They are all back together. It has been a really aggressive start. They've been racing now for 13 minutes. We didn't hear the whistle that time through, so surely the next time around, Gracie, they'll get the whistle for the first of the three intermediate sprints. And I expect to see Keely Bennett come up towards the front. She wears the green Mitchelton jersey as the leader of the sprint classification. She's sitting in around about 12th spot.
Say that there's a couple of other riders that will also want to get their nose in the wind there to try and get some of those sprint points. They're all pretty close on points. We can see Ella Bloor here moving up on the left, number three. She is in the sprint competition at 3 points. So she's only 1 point behind Keely Bennett, alongside a couple of other riders who are also on 3 points. I think they're just going to challenge each other. But another great thing about intermediate sprints is it's a sprint for points, but it's also an amazing launch pad for a counter-attack. So the pace is going to go a little bit higher. The riders are going to try and compete for this sprint for the points, and then we'll see some counter-attacks coming from the bunch behind as everyone wants to take that moment of rest.
Mia Hayden is the rider who is on the front from Team Bridge Lane. She's been followed by Danny DeFrancesco, who was aggressive yesterday and the winner of last year's National Road Series. Yellow jersey, Ruby Roseman Gannon moving around the outside. Gina Ricciardo trying to stick with her. She's number 28 in the blue colours of Team Bridge Lane. And Amanda Spratt, she's sandwiched right in the middle. She's in comfortable territory for her. Great to see Spratty showing such good signs so early in the season.
I got to send Spratty a congratulations message and had a bit of a joke about her sprint because it was super impressive. I think she thought that she might have even won the race. She was very close to winning it, and it's a surprising level of sprint ability from Amanda Spratt. She's definitely underrated in her sprint. Are they going to get the whistle?
And it looks like the commissaire on the left-hand side of the road in the blue was on the whistle. So next time through, they should see the white flag to indicate the first of the three intermediate sprints. All still together.
I'd say Amanda Spratt has been practicing her sprinting with her dad and her brother. I know that they still are very competitive riding as a family up in the Blue Mountains when Amanda Spratt gets to come home in the summer. I can imagine that she was going toe-to-toe with those two, racing for the Christmas pudding back at home left in the fridge after Christmas Day.
The Spratt Cup is a competitive event, I can assure you. Brother Nick is a fantastic national level series rider. Dad as well is super strong, still in his mid to early 60s thereabouts. And he takes no easy steps when it comes to trying to keep up with his kids. In fact, if they have a race, Dad will hang in there for quite a while. It is impressive. Yeah. The whistle has gone, Gracie, so they're on the sprint lap now. And you can see some jostling for position already. And even for those that aren't super motivated for the points but are thinking about the final sprint at the end, this can be a good dress rehearsal.
That's right. You do see a lot of the race favourites go for the first or second intermediate sprints. They often don't go for the last one unless they're really interested in that actual overall category. It is a nice way to activate the legs or get a feel of what the sprint is, where you want to go from. Every sprinter has a slightly different way that they like to sprint and slightly different distance that feels good to them. But we can see an attack going now from one of the Bayside Citroën riders. To me, it looks like Ella Bloor. She's being covered by three other riders.
And looking for the green jersey of Keely Bennett, a few of her teammates from Bridge Lane were riding close towards the front as they made the left-hand turn down alongside Cario Bay. It is Ella Bloor who is on the front setting the pace.
This Rock is a really
salt,
good
trying to close it down.
It's a great move by Ella. It's really good to see a few other riders just seeing that moment as a good opportunity, but it is being closed down, unfortunately. Another of the Bayside Citroën riders is also on 3 points, and that's Lizzie Stannard. So I wouldn't be surprised if you see that bright yellow bike pop out of the peloton shortly. Here you can see her on the left.
There it is. She's following Mia Hayden, trying to get her way up towards the front. The green jersey of Keely Bennett, she's been caught out on the right-hand side, past G4s for Georgia Baker. That's been put together by Cam Plapp, the uncle of Luke Plapp, who's also designed the shoes that Georgia is wearing today. He's one of the local artists from Geelong, and he's got a fair bit of skin in the game with this race. You mentioned Lizzie Stannard. She is right there near the front. There's the fluoro bike. She's in with a chance to collect maximum points. Valentina Scandalara also in the mix. We'll wait for confirmation on those results.
It did look like Valentina Scandalara taking the maximum points there. Lizzie Stannard in third. It also looked like one of the Novotel Prestige Deco riders in second position and just didn't get eyes on the number there.
What we can confirm is that Keely Bennett missed out on the points. And she wasn't right in the thick of the action either. Maybe she's saving herself for an attack that comes after the first intermediate sprint, a chance to do what she did yesterday. And she finished second in two of the intermediate sprints, which was enough to give her the lead. So it was Valentina Scandalara who got the maximum points just ahead of her teammate, Alana Hibar. And then in third position was Lizzie Stannard. So Lizzie Stannard has now picked up 1 point there. So she's moved into equal first position alongside Keely Bennett. So they've both got 4 points each.
We can see these counterattacks going now over the top of that intermediate sprint. It looks to me like Ella Bloor again from the Bayside Citroën team. She's up the road on her own. She needs a couple more riders to form a nice breakaway. There was gaps forming in the back of the bunch as riders were a little bit tired coming out of that intermediate sprint. The pace was high and they just wanted to take that moment of rest. Ruby Roseman Gannon is in a good spot in that front group, making sure she's covering anything dangerous.
It's like Ella Bloor has taken the role of Lizzie Stannard from yesterday. She certainly has been the most aggressive rider so far today. with almost 20 minutes of racing having been covered. If you have just joined us for the first time for the Citroën Bay Crits, this race has been running since 1989. A few interruptions along the way. It hasn't run continuously, but it has made an event most years. It was abbreviated just down to two stages last year. It's back to three stages this year. Yesterday, the opening stage in the women's race was won by Ruby Rose Manganon. The men's was won by Brenton Jones. The final stage is tomorrow, down by the Ferris wheel that you can see in the background on Ritchie Boulevard. Pancake Flat, super difficult though because of the two 180 degree corners. Ella Bloor again,
it's
off the front.
It's actually Matilda Reynolds off the front. They do look quite similar. They're very tall riders for cyclists. There's a lot of riders that are a lot shorter in this peloton, but all of their favourites were up there in the front. I could see Amanda Spratt, Chloe Hosking, Ruby Rose Manganon and Georgia Baker, as well as the team captain in Peter Mullins, just policing the front, making sure Chloe Hosking is always in a good position.
Well, she rode well yesterday, Matilda Reynolds. She finished in eighth position, so she's collected 3 points, but she was eighth as part of the lead out for Ruby Rose Manganon. She finished top 10 without trying to get a result for herself, just supporting her teammate. So she's got good form.
She is on good form. She loves these races. She lives for the summer of cycling. And I know that she just loves to come and learn. She's been racing for a number of years now, but she always tries to take something away from every race. And I think yesterday she certainly learned a lot and got to be in the position of a lead out. She's usually one of the designated sprinters for the teams that she rides in. So to be able to ride as a lead out rider for Ruby Rose Manganon and Georgia Baker, I think it would have been a fantastic experience for her because that is a completely different role. You still have to be really quick, but it's about looking after the people around you, having a bit more periphery, better at communicating. When you're the sprinter, you just have to buckle up and do your job. But when you're the lead out rider, there is just so much to think about and do properly.
There's been a lot of debate in recent years in particular about the length of men's races by comparison to women's races. And Matilda Reynolds, who's off the front on her own right now, she's one of the riders that would certainly benefit from longer races. She's got a diesel engine that can go all day.
She's done very well in some long races. The Melbourne to Warrnambool comes to mind. But she does seem to do a lot of crit racing, so I think it would be better for her to get a bit more experience over in Europe, and she did get to do that this year. She got to do that Kermesse style of racing. So for those unfamiliar with that, it's a kind of a cross between criterium racing and road racing. Over in Belgium and Holland, they do this style of racing called Kermesse racing, and usually the circuits are around 5 to 10 or 15 kilometres. And so they're the distance of a road race, they're probably around 100 kilometres or so, but they're on the smaller circuits. So there's still a lot of corners, a lot of aggressive style of racing, but it suits the engine type of someone like Matilda Reynolds, like you said, she has that really great ability to go all day.
They're raced with the attitude like it's a one-hour race, but it's 100 kilometres so often.
It's brutal.
It is tough style of racing. The crowd, they're making the most of this circuit. They're on the finishing straight, so they can then turn around, take a look back over the hill, and they can see down to the back straight across Corio Bay, and then watch the riders. They make the left-hand turn through to the finish line. They just have to simply turn around and see them whiz on by. Matilda Reynolds on her own. She'd love a little bit of company.
She would. I think she's happy to just tap away at her own pace here. She can maintain a very high level of watts on her own for a sustained amount of time. But being away solo, so much more difficult in a situation like this. You can see the bunch is relatively relaxed in comparison to her crunched over body, trying to get an aero position, trying to find that threshold power where she can just maximize the speed without putting herself into the red zone. But I think the peloton knows that she's not going to be a huge threat despite her strength as a rider. You do need a few more friends out there in a breakaway to really make it a bit more dangerous.
And how well does this work for the yellow jersey, Ruby Rose Manganon, one of her teammates?
That's right. They want to have an aggressive style of race because in the end, it takes the pressure off them. So that they put pressure on the race to then take the pressure off the favourite in Ruby Rose Manganon. So when you have a rider up the road, whether it be solo or in a breakaway, it means that you're then able to say, oh, we can just chill back in the bunch. It's up to the other teams to chase. You don't have to do much because you're saying, we're backing our rider. they're definitely backing Matilda Reynolds because she's away solo. That's the best odds that you can have, a one-up situation. If she can stay away, she doesn't have to sprint against anyone else. But say she was in a break of three or five, they can still back her to win the race and then have someone that can win the race from the bunch behind. So it's a great situation for the Bayside Citroën team.
Looking at it from the perspective of another one of the teams, Novotel Prestige Jayco, the team of Amanda Spratt. Spratt was second yesterday. She'd love to get away from Ruby Roseman Gannon. Perhaps for Amanda Spratt and her team, they don't need to chase. They just need to keep Matilda Reynolds within striking distance. And it could be the launching pad for an attack to come a little later on from Spratty herself.
I'd definitely say that's what she's thinking. It's not necessarily their responsibility, the Novotel Prestige Jayco team, to get on the front. I'd say it's the responsibility of the Roxalt Liv Schramm team and potentially the ARA Skip Capital team. They have a bit more vested interest in a bunch sprint, especially for the Roxalt team, having Chloe Hosking there in their group. So for the Novotel team, they have a bit more of an all-rounder type team, and they want it to be a little bit more dynamic. So they're just going to sit back and go, well, it's the sprinters team's responsibility to drag back Matilda Reynolds, and we're just going to play off that.
It was the view for the spectators. Turn around, watch them down the back straight, make the 180-degree turn as they come through the home straight, making their way alongside Corio Bay. Beautiful spot for a swim. They're less than a kilometre away from the centre of town, which was the host of the World Championships in 2010, where it was Georgia Bronzini who got the win, and she's also a former winner of this series.
Georgia Bronzini loved to come out to Australia. She certainly had some good memories here. We get so many European riders out for the summer of cycling. The Bay Crits have been on the radar of all international riders. It's not just big in Australia, but it's well known around the world as being such a great series. People love to come for the good weather, the good food, the good wine. Australia has it all, and it gets them into such great condition for those early spring races. Often you would see a lot of the Australian riders or the European riders that had come to Australia doing quite well in those first few months of the year because they've got that conditioning for these fast, short races in the hot weather.
And it is hot weather. Two water bottles on board for Matilda Reynolds. She's also taking on a gel to make sure that the petrol tank doesn't hit empty. And we saw an example yesterday as the time gap is around about 18 seconds, the advantage for Matilda Reynolds. Yesterday, Valentina Scandalara, one of your former teammates, the heat, it really looked like it got the better of her towards the back end of yesterday's race.
Yes, I did get a comment from Vale saying that she was struggling a bit in the heat. I don't think she's ever loved it, but if you haven't had enough conditioning here for a few weeks beforehand, it's really going to hurt. And she was being very aggressive in the early stages of yesterday's race. So it's a bit easy to put yourself in the red, unfortunately, and I think that's what happened to her. I think she's being a bit more relaxed in the first 15 or 20 minutes of this race. But we can see Matilda Reynolds really starting to find her rhythm here. She's putting out a pretty high cadence, and I'm sure it's a quite a high power as well. When it's this hot, your heart rate is a little bit higher than usual for the same watts, so that's also something you have to monitor. You have to maybe back off 10 or 20 watts from what you think your threshold power could be for about a 20-minute effort, because that percentage difference with the heat really makes a difference. So you could put yourself into the red much quicker than what you anticipated, and suddenly you go from having this great gap to getting brought back like that. So I think Matilda knows what that feels like to be out there in a situation like this. She's managing it really well. She's eating and drinking. And the peloton behind looks like they don't want to leave her out there for much longer. I could see an ARA Skip Capital rider. It looked to me like Alex Martin-Wallace attacking through that start-finish area. But I think that there's going to be a few riders that either want to try and jump across, or we might see a bit more of a considered effort to try and drag her back.
Looking forward to seeing who it is that does try and get something organised to close it down. But that reaction that has come, it has been brought to heel by the rest of the peloton. It's now Roxalt Liv Schramm who find themselves on the front along with one of the team members from Team Bridge Lane. Yesterday it was Peter Mullins for Roxalt who finished in third position. And it looked as if Chloe Hosking from that team, I thought, was going to be the favourite from that team to get the big result. She kicked the clutch in with about 50 metres to go. And Peter Mullins, so consistent third yesterday. She is bankable every single race she turns up at.
Peter Mullins has probably had more seconds and thirds than anyone, probably on the crit scene. But that is not a critique at all. That's actually an impressive amount of results that she's had in a long amount of time. But the bunch is getting very close now to Matilda Reynolds. It was Amanda Spratt there in that light blue and white jersey of the professional team Trek Segafredo. And Ruby Rose McGannon is making sure to mark her very closely. We can see Georgia Baker from the same team jumping across. It looks like they either want to get band together and work together, or maybe they're thinking that Matilda's time is up and they just send someone else off the front now.
Well, she was just about caught by the peloton. She's now been caught by Georgia Baker, her teammate for the Bayside Citroën squad. Matilda Reynolds has to get out of the saddle sprint to lock into the slipstream of the Triple Commonwealth Games gold medalist from last year. Georgia Baker is stepping up a level with each season, and she's made the transition really well last year from being super focused on the track from the year before heading into the Tokyo Olympics, and with more of a target on the road, and still managing to be elite world-class in both disciplines. It really is impressive.
She's got a big year coming up. She had some great results last year for the team, the bike exchange team. Now, Jayco Ulula, I think she's going to be one of the sprinters to watch on the professional scene. But this has been a big move from Georgia Baker and a huge mistake from everyone else to not cover a potential move in that zone. I think anyone who was trying to get, you know, themselves into the race here have really made a big mistake in missing this huge ride from Georgia Baker to jump across to her teammate Matilda Reynolds. You do not want to have two riders from the same team working together up the front, especially two powerhouses like these two.
Now, both of them finished inside the top 10 yesterday as part of the lead out for Ruby Rose McGannon. Georgia Baker was fifth and Matilda Reynolds was eighth. So Georgia is on 6 points. Ruby Rose McGannon is on 12 points in the race for the yellow jersey. Ruby can sit back and watch her rivals and the teammates of her rivals do all the chasing and then wait for her moment to pounce. She is in the ideal position. Big reaction now, though, coming as they recognise the strength of Georgia Baker off the front.
This is really important, this moment, that you don't want to solidify that break out the front. You wanted to keep that gap as close as possible. You could see the team Bridgelane and the ARA riders, as well as some of the Rock Salt riders, working hard on the front. But then there's been two riders jumping across. You can see Amanda Spratt also jumping across. Danielle DeFrancesco with Peter Mullins on the wheel. They want to make sure that they're not going to miss any more important moves.
Spratt across really quickly. Looks like Chloe Hosking is in that group. There she is, number 20. So it's Chloe Hosking who was amongst those riders that went across.
And the whole bunch has reacted and it's all come back together, but we're seeing another counter-attack. This is a move from Danielle DeFrancesco. She's just gone straight over the top of that break. She's looking really strong out there.
She was strong yesterday too. Being followed now by Peter Mullins. As they've been racing now for 31 minutes, they must be close to the whistle for the second of the intermediate sprints. Normally it's every 15 minutes or so. The race is 50 minutes plus 3 laps. So as soon as they've gone through the 50-minute marker, we'll see them go through the finish line. There'll be the lap board indicating 3 laps to go. They're more than halfway through the race.
That was a really impressive move by Danny DeFrancesco. When you're feeling a little bit better than everyone else is looking and you can just go straight past a breakaway that's been caught, that's a great opportunity to attack. But even if you're suffering, just remembering that everyone else is suffering too and to still take that opportunity. And she's drawn out some of the best riders here. You can see Amanda Spratt in that group, Ruby Rose McGannon, and it looks to me like Peter Mullins. You can see Lizzie Stannard jumping across in this second group of three.
She's been so impressive, Lizzie Stannard. Super aggressive yesterday. She's with that next group that is going across, and the cream is rising to the top at the midway point on stage two of the Citroën Bay Crits. That left hander, it's pretty tricky. You see the gaps open up going through that left hand turn.
I think it is not a particularly technical corner, but I think it looks a bit more scary than it is, and it is a bit off camber. The road conditions here are quite nice. We call it hot mix. That nice smooth road surface, but when it looks off camber, it looks a little bit slippery, and I think it puts off a few people. They never like to take it as quick as you can actually take it. And I think that's where you see some of those gaps opening up. See Ruby Rose McGannon here. She's very motivated to get a group away to work, get them working consistently. I think she's trying to encourage all of these riders here. Chloe Hosking at the rear, Amanda Spratt in those blue and white colours, Peter Mullins and Danny DeFrancesco. This is a really strong group of riders.
The top three from yesterday, plus sixth or seventh yesterday, and the winner of last year's National Road Series in this breakaway group, there should be alarm bells ringing in the peloton. This group out in front is all class.
Pretty much every major team has made it across. There is another ARA skip rider here, a team Bridgelane rider that have also made it across. I think that's it for the peloton. There's not going to be many people that want to put in the chase now that all these major teams are represented.
It looks like Emily Watts has made it across. That's Emily Watts, second last position. ARA Pro Racing Sunshine Coast also there. Looks like Lucy Stewart has made it. And Lucy was impressive yesterday. She was fourth. What a breakaway group. This really is quality.
Lucy Stewart is only 18 years of age and she is holding her head high in this company. She's riding with some of the best riders in Australia. She's doing fantastic.
That is a brilliant performance by Lucy. Similar to both Georgia Baker and we've seen in the past, Alex Manley juggling the track and the road ambitions. And Lucy's got big ambitions on both of the track and the road, and rightly so.
You can see some riders still trying to jump across to try and bridge that gap from the bunch. It's going to be so much harder now that that gap has started to establish, and other riders will tag on the back of those attacks, making sure that no one else gets across. The Bayside Citroën team will be marking any more moves. They'll be nullifying it, as will the Rock Salt Live SRAM team. They have their favorite in there in Chloe Hosking. They don't need any other riders up there. They've got Peter Mullen supporting her. This is a perfect situation for the Rock Salt team, but also the Bayside Citroën team. They'll be covering everything from the peloton behind.
Well, I missed the flag. They went through for the intermediate sprint, in fact, the last time around. So my apologies, missed the flag and also missed the whistles. The winner of that intermediate sprint, it was Danny DeFrancesco. Second place went to Amanda Spratt. Third place went to Ruby Roseman Gannon. But the leader of that classification at the start of the day, Keely Bennett, again missing out on points. She's surrendered, or not surrendered, but she is languishing back in the main peloton. Makes it tough for her to defend that green jersey. But out in front, there was no major sprint in the battle for green, as the green jersey, Keely Bennett, has made it across. I thought she was stuck in the peloton. That is a huge performance to bridge that gap on her own. Well done, Keely Bennett.
That is fantastic. That's a great effort to bridge across. As I was saying, it's pretty difficult now to bridge that gap. It's quite a sizable gap, and the peloton will be covering plenty of moves, but they look like they were happy enough to let her across. She's not a major threat to the other riders in a possible small group sprint. And we can see that bunch behind is the wind's really out of their sails now. There's going to be a few more tries from riders, I'd say. But this is your A group, really, you could call it, this breakaway group. These are some of the best riders in the race, some of our favourites. And I'd say that we're going to see some more attacking coming from this breakaway group as well.
And Keely Bennett, she's just managed to go across. She latches onto Peter Mullins. And now the attack is coming from the yellow jersey. So Ruby Roseman Gannon yesterday, she proved her ability to sprint. She wants to show that she's stronger than everybody else. Emily Watts is starting to struggle at the rear of the group.
I'd say that it's going to be stacks on Chloe Hosking. This group does not want to take her to the finish, but they don't want to take Ruby Roseman Gannon to the finish either. She was a clear winner yesterday. She had a great sprint and a great lead out. She wants to keep making this group smaller and smaller. You want your odds as good as possible. You want to be racing against three other riders, not seven.
Oh, and spare a thought for Emily Watts at the back of that group. You can see the gap to the rider in front of her, perhaps 20 metres, then 20 metres. That is tough, stuck out in the wind on her own, and the gusts are starting to swirl in Geelong. That's a hard position for Emily Watts to be in.
It's really tough. I think she's going to be suffering out there, but I think a lot of these riders are just so stoked that they get to be racing so tough against some of Australia's best riders. It's a pretty cool feeling to be attacked by the likes of Amanda Spratt and Ruby Roseman Gannon. So despite the pain they're in, I think they're still enjoying this day and this experience, and they're going to gain so much from it.
Isn't it a great measure of your progress and getting close to achieving your goals when your childhood hero becomes your rival?
There's nothing better than lining up against your heroes. They say not to meet your heroes, so don't talk to them on the start line, but I know, I'm joking. It's really cool to be able to line up against the people that you've looked up to for so long. I had the pleasure of doing it many years. I always got chills when I got to stand on the start line next to the likes of Mariana Voss and Lizzie Deignan and then race against them. It was certainly pretty intimidating. And it's also, that point as well is important to raise. It's about realizing that you also deserve to be there. They're no better than you. That they don't deserve to be there more than you do. It's really a great experience for these riders to get that feeling of pressure, that feeling of the intimidation, to then go, well, I'm here and I'm doing it, I'm racing, And that's a great thing because they'll be beating their heroes in the years to come.
And that could be the story for number 29, Emily Watts. Less than half a lap ago, she was at the back of the group, looked like she was in a bit of trouble. Now she is at the front of the group. And you mentioned Mariana Voss. There's a great moment of the past couple of seasons was Grace Brown attacking Mariana Voss on the final climb at Liège-Bastogne-Liège, where she ended up coming second to Lizzie Deignan, who you just mentioned as well. 3 years earlier, Mariana Voss was over at the Tour of Margaret River and Grace Brown was part of the National Road Series riding for the Holden team and rode alongside Mariana Voss and just picked her brain the whole way for around about 100 kilometres. So she's had that experience of going from a hero becoming a rival. It was fantastic to see for Grace Brown.
A lot of the Australian riders, including myself, have had the opportunity to ride with some of Europe's best riders within the Green Edge team in its various iterations over the years. And learning from some of the world's best riders is amazing when you get that opportunity to train alongside them and ask lots of questions. I'm anticipating an Amanda Spratt attack coming very soon. I can see her looking around at these other riders. She's in those blue and white colours from the Trek Segafredo team. This is the second day that she gets to wear this kit. She's been in the Green Edge team for 11 years. This is the first year that she's not in it. And she is making the most of it, isn't she, Matt? She's come out flying. She's showing her cards pretty early. I think we've got a lot of good things coming from Amanda Spratt this year.
I'm pretty confident to say that the Trek Segafredo management will be watching the coverage of this and seeing the results of Amanda Spratt as they're over in Europe doing their preparation to get the 2023 season underway. And management will be patting themselves on the back that they signed Amanda Spratt.
That's right. They have their lead manager, the lead DS in Ina Teutenberg, who was also one of the world's best riders. About 10 years ago, she was a top sprinter. She'd won many of the top races, and now she's been directing that women's team since the start, the last 5 years. And I know that Spratty has looked up to Ina for a very long time and probably always wished that she could have been a teammate of Ina's, but now she gets to work with her as Ina's in that DS role. So I think she's going to learn so much from that director in Ina, but also all of the other top riders in that Trek team.
You know Spratty really well. It's not as if she needs anything external to help motivate her, but do you feel as if she's got just a rejuvenated lease on life with her career, with a new team?
I think it's important sometimes to change. You don't want to change for the sake of change, but I think you need to know yourself well enough to know when it's time to shake things up, whether it be getting a new coach or going to a new team or even living in a new city. Over in Europe, a lot of riders do like to move to Girona, but some of them like to move away from Girona and just shake things up. So for Spratty, it's a really great move for her to go to Trek. It is one of the best teams in the world with some of the best riders. And I think she just needed that refresh. She's near the end of her career. She'll probably only be riding for a few more years. She's certainly got a lot left to give, but I think she's just keen to learn and to have some fun with a new group of people and give back as well. She'll be mentoring some of their younger riders. She's mentored so many Australian riders over the years, and I think she's also looking forward to mentoring some non-Australian riders too. It's a great experience to meet new people and to be amongst new cultures, whether they're new team cultures or new cultures from different nationalities.
That's Amanda Spratt at the back of the group wearing number 12. In this race, she rides for the Novotel Prestige Jayco team. Throughout the season, she's part of the Trek Segafredo team. She's one of the greats of Australian cycling. So too is Chloe Hosking. She's the rider who's at the front setting the tempo. Lucy Stewart has made it into this group. She rides for ARA Skip Capital, new team for her this season. Last year, when she was in the under 19 category, she was riding for Inform TMX Make. Now she's across the team that's based out of the Sunshine Coast. She's a really smart bike rider, Lucy Stewart. You won't see her waste any energy. She's marked the right moves and she's got a fearsome sprint.
She loves crit racing. She won the under 19 crit nationals this time last year. So I think she'll be one to watch in the elite nationals coming. I think she's going to be really great in the future, but she's always already showing her strength. But more than that, like you said, her ability to really handle that high-stakes pressure.
The whistle has gone for the third and final intermediate sprint. They've almost done 45 minutes worth of racing. Keely Bennett now has a chance to try and hold on to that green jersey. She needs to win this sprint, Gracie.
I think they might let her too. There might be some riders with some vested interest in this sprint, but they're really thinking about the finish now. So I don't think that she's going to be having too much trouble competing for these points. I think it's important for her to just keep going, keep trying to tally up those points towards that green jersey. There's still another day left of racing tomorrow. But I think many of the riders in this breakaway, they only care about the finish and about the overall for this series.
Well, Keely is on the front early. There's still 1,500 metres to go before she gets back through the finish line. She wears the green Mitchelton jersey as the leader of the points classification. She finished second in two of the three sprints yesterday. She's yet to pick up any points today. She needs this one. She's hoping that if she just does such a big turn of pace that they'll leave her alone and then start the attacking afterwards. I'm not sure it's going to work out that simply for her.
I hope that they'll leave her alone because you don't want to be on the front this early.
She's part of the new Bridge Lane team. For the last couple of seasons, she's been on the Knights of Suburbia squad. Started working at Peak Cycles in Heidelberg as soon as she was old enough as a 15-year-old. She finished up there in the lead into Christmas this year as she's making a full tilt at a campaign on the road throughout 2023. Look over the shoulder from Keely. She knows that they could be coming to surprise her, looking as if she's searching in their eyes to see if she can get some sort of an agreement out of them to leave her alone and take these points. I don't think she's going to have it all her own way. Spratt now coming through to the front. And the peloton's not out of this. The gap still looks as if it's around about the 18 to 19 second mark.
They have not given up. And I think maybe Bayside Citroën are a little bit worried. We see Lizzie Stannard jumping across. I'd say they've been given instructions from the side of the road. Our odds aren't great up there. Sure, we've got Ruby Roseman Gannon, but she's isolated. She doesn't have any teammates up there, whereas Roxalt have two, Bridge Lane have two. It's really difficult when you're the sprinter and you're trying to cover all the moves yourself.
Danny DeFrancesco goes. She won the previous sprint. She wins this one. That will give her 6 points, and she's a chance to take the green jersey for the leader of the points classification. Ruby Roseman Gannon is the second around the corner, and Keely Bennett in green. It looks as if she's going to miss out on points unless she can find something in the final few metres. No, she won't. DeFrancesco takes maximum points, and she will be moving into the lead in the race for green. The pressure again is on at the back. Two riders from Roxalt under pressure, and Emily Watts is distanced for the second time. And that's Lucy Stewart, in fact, followed by Peter Mullen. So those jerseys, they do look so alike from the drone shot. Chloe Hosking from Roxalt is still in that leading group. Lucy doing the chasing, Mullen's on her wheel.
It does look like this front group have sat up a little bit there. They were happy to let Danny get those points. They don't look like they were too motivated to keep working straight away. They're just looking around, see who's there. They could, Amanda Spratt could see that Chloe Hosking was there. Amanda Spratt's going, I'm not going to work with you. I'm not going to drag you to the finish. They're just going to wait and reshuffle the deck. But like I said, from behind, I don't think Bayside Citroën are very happy actually with this situation. They're trying to get riders to jump across. They don't really want to drag the whole bunch back. They're just trying to pop off one or two of their riders to try and get across to this group so then they can support Ruby Roseman Gannon better.
And in the race for the green jersey, Ruby Roseman Gannon, she hasn't been really contesting these intermediate sprints, but she was second in that sprint. She was third in the one before. She already had 3 points yesterday, so she too moves to 6 points, the same amount of points as we see with Danny DeFrancesco. So coming to account back on positions then for stage finish or general classification, it would actually be Ruby Roseman Gannon, who is the leader of that competition. But she's a big chance to hold on to the yellow jersey, so that would go on loan to DeFrancesco tomorrow. Get your abacus out. We've got some calculating to do to work out who's leading what.
That is tricky sometimes with the jerseys. Often the wearer of jerseys has multiple, especially in the sprint competition, because Ruby Roseman Gannon is always putting herself in the best position. She doesn't really want to go for those points, but she doesn't want to let anyone else up the road in a dangerous situation. So she's always around the mark, and therefore she's getting those points. I'm just waiting for the next counterattack now coming from this group. I'm really looking at Amanda Spratt as to be the next main aggressor. She's at the back. She's looking around. She's trying to reassess how everyone else is looking, seeing at their body language, see who's suffering. She's getting out of the saddle, seeing how she's feeling. I think this group is going to start to play that cat and mouse game a little bit more now that we're getting close to the finish.
Well, 48 minutes of racing having been covered. The format for the race is 50 minutes and then they get 3 laps to go. So it will be close next time through. We may not see the board. If we don't, I'm sure that we'll see the 3 laps to go the next time around. Lucy Stewart, number 16 on the Factor bike, riding for ARA Skip Capital. at the back, Peter Mullins. Mullins, along with Lucy Stewart, they were distanced on that previous lap, as was Emily Watts. All three of them have rejoined. Ruby Rose Manganon in yellow. She looks so composed.
She does look composed. She is such a mature rider for her age. I think that Amanda Spratt is marking her now. Maybe Spratty doesn't want to go for the sprint, but we can see the bunch coming very quickly from behind now. Spratty just noticed that too and is taking her opportunity to try and split this group up again, split the bunch up. The bunch has to react.
And three laps to go. You can see the board on the left-hand side of the screen. Three laps remaining. The peloton reeling the breakaway in. The game of cat and mouse out in front gave the peloton a chance. Now Spratt is on the charge, but she hasn't opened up the gap. The reputation of Amanda Spratt means that if she flinches, everybody reacts. They want to stick with Spratt.
That's right. I reckon Spratt would also love to try her hand at this sprint. This sprint actually suits her better than yesterday. She did so well yesterday to get second, and it was a close second as well, but the uphill kicker, a lot closer to the finish line, a tight left-hand corner. She's got good skills, and she's a great climber, and we can see she's got a bit more power now in her sprint. Maybe she also just wants to mark Ruby Rose Manganon and see how she can fare in this sprint, but we can see another Bayside Citroën rider attacking. Looks like a rock salt rider trying to jump across as well. The whole bunch is just strung out. No one wants to let anyone go now.
Impressive performance by the peloton, and it speaks volumes of the depth within this race. The quality of that breakaway group, I thought for sure, if they stay organised, they will stay away. But it has been closed down. And now it is Bayside Citroën once again going on the attack. It looks like it could be Georgia Baker who is the one that is forcing the issue at the front.
It does look like Georgia Baker. She is such a strong rider. She's coming from the track background, so their efforts are about that 4 or 5 minute distance. She can put out a huge amount of power for a good amount of time, so you don't want to let her off the front close to the finish. She can really hold it and carry it all the way to the finish line. They're teammates now are attacking, counter-attacking Georgia Baker as she got brought back. It looks like Matilda Reynolds going off the front now, being marked very closely.
Yet again, Matilda Reynolds, so aggressive at the start of the race. The yellow jersey, though, Ruby Rose Manganon, despite that breakaway being caught, she hasn't drifted back in the peloton. She stayed up towards the business class seats. She's inside the top 10, followed by Spratty.
And they're also followed by Chloe Hosking. These top riders are all marking each other now. Ruby Rose Manganon is for sure the most marked rider. No one is letting her out of their sights. Some of the riders now are getting dropped from the back. Lizzie Stannard, who's done a great amount of work, she's just getting back into the bunch there. She's going to try and help her teammates in those last couple of laps as much as she can. I'd say that the Bayside team still want to keep this aggressive all the way to the finish.
The green jersey in the middle of the peloton. There's two green jerseys, but the one that is in the middle is the leader of the points classification. At least she was at the start of today's stage. Keely Bennett, she won't be at the end of the stage. It's going to come down to a count back as to who's the leader of that classification. Another attack going.
This is Ella Bloor
this time, who is on the move with two laps remaining.
And it looks like a rock salt rider trying to jump across with Ella. An ARA Skip Capital rider also just trying to tag onto that group there. It looked about 4 or 5 riders just trying to jump away from the front of the bunch. This is a great opportunity to attack as the riders in the bunch are getting tired. They don't want to keep going for attacks or covering them. They're also thinking about their lead outs for the sprint. And that's a really great moment to try and get that last minute attack to be successful because of that change in the mentality of the bunch. You're either tired or you're thinking about what the bunch sprint is going to look like. And that's where you can capitalize on that momentary lapse of concentration. And Ella Bloor's done a great job here to lure out a few riders. A group of 4 is a really good number of riders to just go hard, as hard as you can. They've only got less than 2 laps to go now. That they need to just fully commit and ride as hard as possible and just hope that they've got the legs to finish it off in the sprint.
So 2 laps, they're less than 4 kilometres from the finish of stage 2 of the Citroën Bay Crits for 2023. The white colours of Bayside Citroën, they've been so aggressive throughout the race. They've got the yellow jersey with Ruby Rose Manganon. She's now in the peloton with a teammate forcing the issue. A break of 4. The challenge for them now, Gracie, is can they stay organised?
That is a really important point, Matt. They need to work together cohesively immediately. They have started riding pretty hard together. they're starting to look at each other now too, and they're also looking behind their shoulders to see what the bunch is doing behind, and that means that their pace is dropping a little bit. They're not 100% committing because they're not quite sure what they should or shouldn't be doing. They want to get some information from their teammates, but this bunch, they're dragging them back so quickly. They're just saying, no, not today, girls.
It looks like Valentina Scandalara on the front, who's closing things down, working for the Novotel Prestige Jayco team, and one of the teammates of Spratty. It is Valet Scandalara. Chloe Hosking is towards the front. So too is the yellow jersey Ruby Roseman Gannon. Here comes Spratty on the attack. It's the Sprat attack. She's been followed by Danny DeFrancesco. They'll respond to any move by Amanda.
We knew it was coming. We knew that Amanda Spratt was keen to do one big attack in this race. She's left it right for the end. Georgia Baker was also there, making sure that she wasn't getting to let anything go that was dangerous. Georgia Baker did a great job in the lead out for Ruby Roseman Gannon yesterday, but they're looking a little bit disorganized now. I think this final lap is going to be quite chaotic. The teams need to get more organized for this lead out, and Matilda Reynolds is capitalizing on this situation.
The bell goes, 1.8 kilometers remaining. It's Matilda Reynolds who is now off the front on her own. She spent 15 minutes at the start of the race off the front. She was eighth yesterday. Her teammate Ruby Roseman Gannon won the stage. Matilda was part of the lead out. Now they have to chase her.
And whose job is it to chase Matilda Reynolds? Everyone from many of the teams, Rock Salt team, the ARA Skip Capital team, Team Bridge Lane, and the Novotel Prestige Jayco team, they've all been working to bring back breakaways, to jump into breakaways, to bridge across to breakaways. And they're going, whose job is it now? It's your job. No, it's your job. So that's where a rider like Matilda Reynolds can stay away and win this race.
This is a huge moment for Matilda. This is the final tight left-hand turn down towards Corio Bay. Then she has the journey along the back straight and then the tight punch up towards the finish line. We pan back on the drone to see what the gap is, and it is a significant one for Matilda Reynolds. The moment of pause within the peloton, she may have pounced just at the right moment.
This is a great move from Matilda Reynolds. She's been much more controlled today. Yesterday, I think she was just riding in the front a little bit too much. I think she's really starting to learn, get the hang of it in this series again. After a couple of months away from racing, she's just seen that opportunity, and that's what racecraft is. It's racing on instincts. It's saying, I'm hurting, but so is everyone else, and here is the moment where I go. I think it's going to be touch and go. That bunch is slowly bringing that gap back, and now the road creeps up a little bit. It drags up. This is where she's going to be really hurting. That lactic acid is starting to go super high. She needs to maintain that pace now as the road drags up.
The legs are starting to scream. She takes a look across the shoulder. Matilda Reynolds is fading ever so slightly. The lead on is being teared by ARA Capital. They're doing the job. It is then Georgia Baker, followed closely by the yellow jersey. Baker now opens up. Ruby Roseman Gannon behind her. It is then Chloe Hosking, followed by Spratty. Keely Bennett is there in the green jersey. The black is Danny DeFrancesco. The big lead out by the G-Force, sweeping through the left-hander. She's got plenty of momentum. Here comes yellow. Ruby going for back-to-back. Chloe trying to challenge. Keely in for a spot on the podium. Ruby holding on. She makes it two. She wins again. Keely Bennett in second. Chloe Hosking in third. Huge ride by the Bayside Citroën team. They had Matilda Reynolds off the front for the final lap. Others had to do the chasing. Georgia Baker took over and Ruby finished it off to perfection.
That was wonderful racing from the Bayside Citroën team. Now, the tactic we can talk through is Matilda Reynolds' attack. If you don't have a full lead out, it's actually quite advantageous to go on the offensive like Matilda did, because that means the Bayside team that maybe only had Georgia Baker to lead out Ruby Roseman Gannon just can take the rest that they needed in the wheels and force other teams like the ARA Skip Capital and Rock Salt Live SRAM to then chase and use up their riders that they needed for the lead out. Georgia Baker had such a strong surge of power there going into that final corner. They absolutely nailed the timing. Matilda Reynolds' move really helped them to set that final corner up for the team, and Ruby Roseman Gannon just finished it off perfectly. She is obviously in amazing form to win on two different finishes and clearly be stronger than everybody else. I'm really impressed with Keely Bennett to hold on there for second after racing a pretty tough race. She had to bridge across that long gap to the breakaway about 15 minutes before the finish, so she would have been still hurting from that, and to finish it off with a second place finish is a fantastic result in the green jersey today. Chloe Hosking, I think, is going to be a bit happier with her third place today. But let's see if we can hear eavesdrop some of their comments from this cool down lap that they're getting.
Oh, really? Colin. Colin.
Yeah, makes sense.
Fantastic team win. Georgia Baker and Ruby Rose Mangana just debriefing on how they managed to get the job done. And it was the performance in that final corner. But you mentioned it before, Gracie, the ride by Keely Bennett in second, that's one of the best performances in her career.
I think she'll be really happy with that, really proud of herself. She's come in second, but she's beat some of the best riders in this race, in Chloe Hosking, Amanda Spratt. I think Spratty might be a bit disappointed with her finish. I think she was really hoping to try and go one better, to try and win this race, and that on the finish that would have suited her a little bit better. But she had a really big attack quite close to the finish. I think that would have really put her a bit into the red there and just taken off that sting that she needed to get through that final tough last corner going into the finish line. But Ruby Rose Mangannon, such a classy bike rider. She made it look easy this time last year, but she's got a whole year of professional racing in her legs now, and she's got some great support there from riders such as Georgia Baker, who did such a fantastic lead out for her, but also Matilda Reynolds having a super strong race, a very aggressive race, particularly with that last solo attack in the last lap.
There is Matilda, number four. She was brilliant early in the race as well. She was ever present throughout stage two of this series. There's one day to go. That is tomorrow around Ritchie Boulevard. A completely different style of circuit to this one. Ruby Rose Mangannon with back-to-back victories. Second place today was Keely Bennett from Team Bridge Lane. Third place was Chloe Hosking. In fourth was Danny DeFrancesco. Fifth was Georgia Baker. Tilly Field from Rock Salt Lipschram was sixth. Peter Mullins was seventh. Amanda Spratt was eighth. Gina Ricciardo was ninth. And Georgia Whitehouse was in 10th spot. An impressive element for me from Keely Bennett in second position was she would have been within her rights, be a bit disappointed of missing out on getting the points for the green jersey. She clearly had the green jersey in mind. And then she had the maturity to regather her thoughts and target the stage victory. And she didn't get the win, but she came desperately close in second.
That's a great point, Matt. And that's a really good lesson to learn from racing, is it's not over till it's over. You've really got to race the race. You've got to race the whole race. Sure, you might have some small ambitions within the race, and it's really important to have some process goals or some smaller goals that are not the overall outcome. But you also just don't want to give up either if things don't go your way. Sometimes you might not feel good. You don't get the intermediate points you were hoping for. And mentally, that can really bring you down in a race, and then you don't even try at the finish. So that's a really great show of maturity for her to still put herself in that position to go for a result at the end of the race, despite not getting the results she wanted with those intermediate sprints. So I think that was a fantastic turnaround and a great example of that kind of racing.
And she was one of the first riders that Team Bridge Lane wanted to sign. They were pretty keen to get her across to the team, and for good reason. Blake Quick warming up and having a bit of fun trying to put it on the back wheel.
Luckily, he kept it on the back wheel. You don't want to have a little crash before the race, especially in front of all the spectators, but he looked like he had it covered. A lot of the men would be paying attention to the last few laps of the women's race. They would have been doing their own warm-ups in the team zones on their trainers, or out on the surrounding roads of the region, but they would have made sure that they were watching the last few laps of the women's race because they want to see how that finish was handled,
what the wind conditions are. It helps them to then decide how they're going to race.
And number four in the yellow jersey.
Yeah, it was a great race. We put on a show. We tried to attack a lot. So, and I think you saw that right until the end with Matilda's last attack, which we were hoping that would stay away. But yeah, I can't thank them enough. And Georgia gave me the perfect lead out yet again. So I really appreciate it.
What about the tactics with about a third to go? Everyone that mattered was in that breakaway. The gap was big. Much talking going on. I don't think anyone wanted to drag you to the finish though, did they?
Yeah, I think it was a bit a messy break. I think it sort of came together and then people weren't keen to work together and I was. And then all of a sudden I was like, I'm outnumbered and I stopped working and everyone wanted to work again. So, I think a break of that size in this sort of race probably won't ever be, unless it's got the right combination. And if we had had numbers, we would have pushed it. But, yeah, it wasn't a smart decision for us.
One day to go. It's as good as it gets, isn't it, for you? I think. Unofficially, but you've just about got an unassailable lead. But tomorrow is the hot dog. It's a tricky circuit. You've still got to get around it, don't you?
Yeah, I've only raced that once, and that was start of 2020 with Spratty, and it was a very hot day, and I was just hanging on to her wheel for dear life, and she won that race. So special memory for me because I was awestruck sort of riding with my idol, and I'm keen to get back on that course. It's really fun.
Good luck. Well done today.
Thank you so much.
Oh, congratulations to Ruby Rose Manganon. She does have an unassailable lead, but wouldn't she love to make it 3 from 3 with a completely different style of circuit tomorrow?
I really think she can. She's showing that she is head and shoulders above the rest. She's not racing conservatively here. She is racing aggressively herself. She's not sitting back as the sprinter waiting for it to be delivered to her on a silver platter. She's making the race hard for everybody else, and that shows us what great form she's in. So I think she's going to be a very tough one to beat tomorrow. She's got great team support around her with the Bayside Citroën team. There's plenty of riders that don't want to walk away empty-handed from this series, so I think that she is going to have a tough one cut out for her on the last stage, but she's still clearly the favourite, isn't she, Matt?
Yeah, it's a very different style of stage tomorrow to be able to control. You really need to take control very early on in the race. And tomorrow is the sort of circuit where we can see as little as 10 to 15 riders actually finish on the same lap. Because once you get lapped there, they get taken out. Let's take a look at the men's as we're about to turn our attention to that race. It was Brenton Jones who got the win yesterday ahead of Graham Frizzley. Blake Angeletto was in third position. Craig Wiggins fourth. Miles Stewart in fifth. Blake Quick was in sixth, but he was the first rider to have his hands up yesterday. He did the lead out for Brenton Jones.
It was a great lead out from the men's Bayside Citroën team. They had a lot of riders there working in support of Brenton Jones. We weren't sure whether they were going to set it up for Blake Quick or Brenton, but what a finish. We were buzzing back here in the studio, knowing that it meant so much to Brenton, but it also meant so much to his mum, Karen Jones. He was a very key organiser here at the Bay Crits series, and they had a lot of family members out there at the finish line too. But I think that there's a few riders in the men's field that want to make amends for yesterday. They didn't get it quite right, particularly the ARA Skip Capital team. They had three riders there, all in the top 5 or 6. So I think that they would like to do one better and get a win. And also Team Bridge Lane, I think they would also like to get a couple of their riders a bit further up there. They were quite aggressive, but I think that they're hoping to get a proper result.
Yeah, the ARA Skip Capital, they were consistent. They finished in 3rd, 4th, and 5th. Angeluto, Wiggins, and Stewart. They'd love to swap that and have only one rider inside the top 10, but have that rider in first spot.
That's right. I think it's a great result to have 3rd, 4th, and 5th, but it's also potentially a little bit embarrassing. You don't want to have that many riders up there because it means that your team plan didn't exactly go to plan. A lead out means that you've got one guy being slingshot into the best speed possible so they can win the race, cross that line first. So I think that they're going to have to recalibrate and do a little bit better today. But having riders in that top 5 isn't a bad thing. They just need to nail that final corner a little bit better than they did yesterday. The Bayside Citroën team did a fantastic job with their lead out. They gapped the field in those last couple of corners and they had the perfect run all the way to the finish.
So the top 10 in the general classification, they all get called to the front. So that gives them a good starting position, which is even more important tomorrow on the tight Ritchie Boulevard circuit. Cameron Ivory, the current Australian Criterium champion, eighth yesterday. The far left of the screen in the red and the yellow colours, that is Jacob Langham. He's racing here as an individual. He doesn't have any teammates, so he's doing his own thing. That really is a great result for Jacob. He's got to be pretty happy with that outcome, with his performance. Here's a look at the circuit. 1.9 kilometres each lap, and they're going a different direction to what they went yesterday. It's 50 minutes plus three laps and two intermediate sprints along the way. And that final left-hand corner, it's so tight, Gracie. It is crucial.
That final left-hand corner is tight, and it goes up as well. So you need to be a very strong rider, not just a fast sprinter. You need to have that extra power to get over that steep kicker and hold it all the way to the line. It feels like the line gets stretched out ahead of you because it just never seems to come quick enough. It's a slow sprint, and you want to be in a good position on that final corner as well.
Graham Frizzley in the green colours up at the front of the race as well. All smiles as he has a chat with Brenton Jones. Riding for the Cachet team. New sponsor on board, replacing Oliver's Real Food Racing, but still in the green colours that they previously were. In the race for the green jersey, in that points classification, to the left-hand side of the screen as you look at it from Brenton Jones, that's Tom Chester. He's the leader of the points classification. He's on 6 points. James Moriarty is second on 3 points. Also on 3 points is Elliot Schultz and Kane Richards. Simon Clark is fifth. They are underway. Stage two for the men in the Citroën Bay Crits. Back-to-back victories for Ruby Roseman Gannon. Brenton Jones would love to replicate that.
He certainly would. He had a fairy tale ride yesterday, but I think they want to keep the fairy tale going as long as possible, all the way until tomorrow. For him, he's never actually got to wear the yellow jersey. He's only won it at the end of the series that he has won. So today is going to be pretty special. Donning that special yellow jersey is always a lovely feeling, to wear a leader's jersey in any competition, but particularly in a competition that really is close to home for him and his family.
And you take a look at the Strava data from a few of the riders within the race, and you can see the different objectives that they have based on what they did this morning. Brenton Jones went out and he rode 35Ks. Nice recovery ride, flush the system of any lactic acid or fatigue from yesterday. Simon Clark went for a gentle ride this morning as well, 152 kilometres. So he's obviously targeting something very different to what Brenton Jones is.
That's right. Simon Clark is wanting to do well at the Nationals, but I'd say he's also got his sights set on some big results over in Europe this year. We can see one rider already attacking. They took off from the start line pretty quick, so I think this bunch is pretty serious about having a fast race and an aggressive race today.
A yellow jersey of Brenton Jones, just trying to keep that together. He'll get his teammates around him in the white colours of Bayside Citroën, plus the blue, the navy blue and the red of the Ineos colours of Luke Plapp, who is part of the Bayside Citroën team at this race. It really is the all-star team of the Bay Crits. At the back of the race, this is Nick Locandro. He's riding as an independent within the race. Got the Tri-Velo colours on. And he's strung out early. This is a rapid start, Gracie.
It does look like it's a bit of a tailwind on this bottom straight, which means that if the pace is high, it's really difficult once you've been dropped to try and get back into that group. So as soon as it starts stringing out, it's like motor pacing when you've got a tailwind like that. And it can really burn the legs more than you realise.
There's number seven, Simon Clark, at the back for the Novotel Prestige Jayco team. The rider that I mentioned just a moment ago knocked out a lazy 152 Ks this morning after breakfast. Perfect preparation for an afternoon race. It really is, for a guy like Simon Clark, setting up the season, setting up the national championships, and for him, hopefully, a pretty big result at the Tour Down Under.
I think he wants some big results this year. He's probably near the end of his career as well, so he's just making the most of every opportunity, like he did last year, winning a stage of the Tour de France when he was without a contract at the start of the year. That's a pretty fairy tale story if you ask anyone, but I think he's wanting even more than that this year.
It was the fairy tale story of the season. And throughout the Tour de France of last year, when he won that stage, he was still without a contract for 2023. But he has signed a two-year extension with the Israel Premier Tech team, and he's been one of the best signings for that squad across the last couple of years, despite some of the really big names that that team has got on board, including the great Chris Froome, who's not as great as he used to be, but what a CV, one of the all-time best.
It would have been pretty amazing to ride with Chris Froome at the Tour de France for Simon Clark. Both of them would have been mentors for many of the other riders on that team, but the Israel Premier Tech team has been quite a nice breeding ground for developing some of the Aussie talent. We had Zach Dempster working as a director there, and they've brought on many young Australian riders, some of which have come from the ARA Skip Capital team over the last couple of years. So there's definitely a nice Australian connection there. And then getting to ride with the likes of Simon Clark and Chris Froome, I think that's a pretty amazing way to start your career.
It has been a good link for some of the young Aussies on that squad. Peloton still strung out. A super fast start to stage two and a few under pressure at the back. You lose a little gap on the left-hand turn down towards Corio Bay. You find yourself chasing the whole way along the back straight and then you turn sharply uphill to the finish line.
Yeah, there's not a lot of room for rest on this course, actually. It's harder than it looks. And you're right, if you have any gaps there going on that fast downhill onto the bottom straight, it can be quite difficult if you can't ride quicker than 60k an hour to get back onto the back of that group. But there's plenty of riders working pretty hard to improve their position, potentially trying to set themselves up to go with a breakaway or even make a breakaway.
It looks like it's Connor Sens who is going on the attack. Another one of the independents in the race, based out of Bendigo. What a training track he has to prepare for. Flick of the elbow. Connor had a pretty good season last year in Italy, looking for more of the same again this year. He rode well at the national championships last year too.
The Bayside Citroën team had a couple of guys up there making sure they're covering the moves. They're going to have their work cut out for them today. I think many teams want to make it tough for them, try and isolate some of their riders, particularly isolating Brenton Jones and Blake Quick, who will be sitting back in the bunch trying to do as less amount of work as possible to save themselves for the sprint. But if the race just gets more and more aggressive, then they're going to be also having to put themselves up into the front to cover some of the moves because their teammates just won't be able to cover everything.
You would not, though, want to be in a breakaway today without one of the members of that team in the move.
No, that's for sure. They will be making sure that if they're not in it, they'll bring it back very quickly. And they've got the horsepower to do so, particularly with Luke Clapp, who was on the front for the majority of yesterday's race.
Didn't he do an enormous job yesterday, Luke Clapp? He's got a great team sport culture, Luke Clapp. He went to Maribyrnong Sports School, a secondary college, which has a really high focus on sport and giving scholarships to young aspiring athletes to make sure that they're balancing their education and their pursuit of sport as well. And he initially went there with a scholarship to play cricket, not cycling.
It's funny the directions that you go in and some of the forks in the road that come your way, but aren't we glad that he ended up choosing cycling? He's been a great junior cyclist and now he is becoming one of Australia's best elite cyclists, and he could be one of the favourites going into the road race at Nationals on this coming weekend to defend his title.
There he is, number five. He still rides the bike as the Australian champion. He enjoyed his stint in the green and gold throughout his first big campaign in Europe, and last year he rode his first Grand Tour at the end of the season. He got a late call-up for the Vuelta a España, and he put in a strong performance. There's Cameron Ivory, the Australian national champion. Good start yesterday to his Bay Series campaign. Cameron Ivory finishing in eighth position. So he's on 3 points. Brenton Jones leads on 12 points. Graham Frizzley in second on 10, followed by Blake Angelotto in third on 8 points.
It's Cam Ivory that gets to wear the national champion's jersey in this race because he's the national crit champion. And actually, you don't get to wear the crit champion's jersey that many times in a season. You get to wear it at some of the NRS races that have crits there. So Luke Clapp won't be wearing it today because it's a rule, but mostly out of respect for the crit champ. You don't want to be wearing the jersey as the road champion. But Cam Ivory wouldn't have been able to wear that jersey too many times this year. He does mostly mountain biking, so he would have worn it at some of the NRS races. Some riders get to take that crit champ's jersey over to America and do all of those crit races over there, but you don't really get to ever wear the crit champ jersey in Europe because they don't really do crits over there.
Good place, isn't it, the US, for an Australian criterium champion to go and race for a season. Plenty of circuit racing there, taking racing into the heart of some of the major cities. Pace calms down momentarily, but I'm sure it won't be for too long as you see riders who have been caught at the back making a dash up the left-hand side of the peloton, trying to improve their position under brakes on this tight turn.
You have to take every opportunity to improve your position if that's your aim of today. Some riders are happy to stay out the back, but it's a bit of a concertina effect. So even if you're a sprinter that's waiting for the finish, you don't really want to get involved in the sprints. You don't really want to be spending too much time at the back because you are going to be working harder as the pace goes higher on the corners and there's more accelerations coming out of those corners. But if you're a rider that is interested in the breakaways, you need to be constantly moving yourself up. There's a bit of a saying in the bunch, if you're not moving forward, you're going backwards because of that swarming effect of the bunch. And you see some riders here who were in good position, suddenly are not because there's so many riders that keep coming around them.
You can get swamped so quickly. They've been racing now for just on 9 minutes. This race is 50 minutes plus three laps. The cachet colours, the green team. We saw number 21 at the back of the peloton for a long time yesterday. That's Graham Frizzley. He ended up in second position. He looks so cool, calm and collected towards the back. And I've spotted him again. Number 21, not quite at the back, but Gracie, he's pretty close.
That's right. There's some riders that are more relaxed to stay back there. Sometimes they don't really want to get involved in that chaotic mess at the front, that swarming effect. There's constant bumping of elbows, people being quite aggressive towards each other, let alone being aggressive in their attacking style. And you just want to stay away from that. But you're risking being on the wrong end of a split in the bunch or the wrong side of a crash that can stop you. So sometimes you're lucky, you might get a free lap given by the commissaire. But if you're not involved in a crash, you didn't have a mechanical, you're the one that has to chase.
We saw it yesterday with three laps to go. There was a few riders involved in a fall and they were unable to get that advantage of a lap out because it was inside the business end of the race. So they were very firmly out of contention. Luke Plapp now on the front, controlling the tempo. So a couple of riders as they went through the start finish line. The last time riding here is Independence, one of them from the Oniva team, the other one from St. George Continental. And their kit looks almost identical. It really does become themes within pelotons, doesn't there? And at the moment, we're seeing ARA, Skip Capital and Team Bridge Lane with really similar looking jerseys.
That's right. I think the theme the last couple of years has been a nice blue, pink, purple blend. So it's nice. I love to see the Cage team still retaining that bright green. It makes it easier for us commentators to pick them out. It's nice and bright. I think the difference between the Bayside Citroën men's team and the women's teams in this series is that the women's team seems to want more of an aggressive race, whereas the Bayside Citroën men's team is a bit more happy to just be covering moves, using riders like Luke Plapp to control the bunch more because they know that they've got that power for the sprint finish. And they, because the men's bunch is a bit bigger, you do lose control quite quickly if you're a bit over aggressive. So if you're constantly sending riders up the front to make moves, you can also open yourself up to attacks if they don't go to plan and riders aren't covering enough or they're not having a good day. So a bunch size like this, you do need to ride a little bit more conservative if you know that you've got that firepower to finish it off in a bunch sprint.
James Moriarty now trying to go off the front. He's looking for points in the race for the Mitchelton green jersey. He sits in second position in that classification. Moriarty is on 3 points. Tom Chester is the leader. Tom's on 6 points. But Tom doesn't have any teammates. He's from Canberra. You know him reasonably well. He's out there on his own.
He is riding for himself today. He's riding in the Blackshaw team that is from Canberra. There are a couple of other Blackshaw riders, but the other one, Ben Hill, is riding for the Novotel Bayside Prestige team. So he's just going to have to make the most of it out there today on his own. But he did very well yesterday riding in that breakaway. And it's pretty nice that he gets to wear that green jersey today.
And somehow, in the space of the end of the women's race and the start of the men's race, the temperature has dropped around about 5 degrees and the wind has fallen away. The cool change has come through and the conditions have calmed down.
I'm sure that's a big relief to many riders. Even if you're an Aussie rider that's been training in the Aussie summer the last couple of months, it just hasn't been hot enough anywhere to really get that conditioning. So most riders would have struggled a lot yesterday in that 35 degree heat, and it feels so much hotter when you're on that tarmac, doesn't it, Matt?
Yeah, and a lot of research has been done in sports sciences, the impact of heat on performance, and it has a huge impact.
It really does. You have to do a lot of heat acclimatization. You can do that by training in the heat. You can do it by using hot baths or saunas, making yourself hot while you're training. But it is quite dangerous as well. So you need to do it in a very monitored way with some good coaching or sports science support to do it properly. But you don't want to be overly dehydrating yourself or putting yourself under heat stress without the proper management, but it can really affect the way you race. So it changes your threshold power because your heart rate is higher. Your body, we say cook it, you cook yourself, and literally that's what you're doing. You're cooking your body from the inside out. So unless you can use ways of cooling, such as using ice water, riders like to use slushies in their drink bottles even, you need to cool that core temperature, because if you cannot keep that core temperature stable or stop it from rising, you just can't keep going at the pace that they're going. And you'll see a lot of riders just go into the red zone a lot quicker. Their heart rate just cannot come down at all, and they just cannot maintain this pace.
And the pace is really quick. They've been racing now for a little over 13 and a half minutes, almost 14 minutes. So when they come through, we may well get the whistle for the first of the three intermediate sprints. Tom Chester leads that classification, 3 points clear of James Moriarty, Elliot Schultz and Kane Richards. A little indecision at the front of the peloton. And the whistle has gone for the first of the intermediate sprints. Where is Tom Chester? He doesn't have any teammates to drag him to the front. He's going to have to do it on his own. Also in the green colours, the team that is in the green colours, the Cachet team, they're looking for James Moriarty to try and pick up some points for him. Elliot Schultz from Team Bridge Lane, he picked up his points through being in the breakaway yesterday. He's not renowned as a sprinter, but he still may well try and get himself into the mix and move a little bit closer to the lead of the Mitchelton points classification.
The points don't usually spread out too much on the first day, so the second day of racing is still quite hot to get that green jersey. You can leapfrog your competitors pretty quickly if you get a couple of points and they don't get any in the sprint intermediate sprint points.
We saw that in the women's race. Keely Bennett, she rode so well. She finished second on the stage, but she missed out on points at the intermediate sprints, and she has now slipped away from the lead of that classification. That is being led by Ruby Roseman Gannon, who also leads the series overall. Ruby has an unassailable lead in the race for yellow, but she can be beaten in the race for green, and no doubt tomorrow she'll be aiming for a hat trick. Heading down the back straight, alongside Cario Bay, the tempo increased in as they head towards the first of the three intermediate sprints. It looks like Tom Chester on the left of the peloton, improving his position without sticking his nose in the wind yet.
It is hard to tell him apart from the Cache riders.
Well, it won't be him going all the way to the front, surely. He'll be trying to stay in the slipstream.
Well, I think the Cache team do want to get James Moriarty up there to also gain some points.
It's Dylan Ethu's on the front. And there's the green jersey that's not part of the green team, sitting now in third position. So a great spot for Tom Chester. He's on the wheel of big Kane Richards, and Kane Richards is just 3 points behind in the battle for green, so he's right in contention for this classification too.
There's plenty of other riders that also want to get up to there for this sprint, not necessarily for the points, but because it's a good launching pad for a potential breakaway. So I think that we might see this bunch split up one way or another as we go through this start-finish area.
Jack Aiken also trying to move up the inside. The sprint is on. Blake Quick is in there amongst it. And it is Quick who collects maximum points ahead of Craig Wiggins. And Tom Chester just missed out. He didn't get any points. He finished in fourth. We'll wait for confirmation though.
That must be frustrating for him, knowing that those other riders don't really care about that sprint classification. It would mean a lot more to him than to them as they're going for those overall categories and stage wins. Blake Quick looks like he's opening up the throttle to maybe go for the result at the end of this stage. What do you think, Matt? Do they ride for Brenton Jones keeping in the jersey, or do they go for Blake Quick today?
I think they go all in greedy to try and win everything. They'll be looking for Blake Quick to take the green jersey. He won 3 points then. That moves him to four. The current lead is six, so he's within striking distance. Second in the sprint was Craig Wiggins, picking up 2 points. Third was Miles Stewart, so Tom Chester didn't get any points. I think Blake will race for green, and they'll support the yellow jersey of Brenton Jones to keep the yellow jersey all the way through to the end of tomorrow. We'll find out soon enough.
They'll probably go 1-2 today.
There's a big chance. Blake Quick yesterday, he was the first one with his arms up celebrating the victory of his teammate. He finished in sixth position on the stage yesterday. Last year, Blake Quick, he won both stages and won the series overall. This year, there's three stages, the final day being tomorrow, starting a little later tomorrow, closer to a 6 p.m. kickoff down on Ritchie Boulevard.
You can see this rider that is attacking off the front of the bunch. He is getting a bit of a gap, but it is so much harder to get a good aggressive breakaway when you attack from the front. You could see a lot of riders there seeing him do it, and they're all just jumping across. The pace is so high across that the first half of that bottom straight. In that tailwind, it's still almost downhill. It starts to drag uphill from here, but there's plenty of opportunity to then jump across from a breakaway that just pops off from the front.
Do you think the course going this way, it's the exact same course at opposite direction, you think this way is more difficult or yesterday?
I do think that this direction is more difficult. It's both directions is hard to get a breakaway going on this course. It always has been. You have to time it right more than there's a particular spot on the course that's good for it. It's more about using your instinct to find those moments of hesitation in the bunch. Everyone's expecting attacks to go on the uphill kicker, as we saw yesterday, in the opposite direction. So there's always people anticipating that will easily go with it. It's about finding those moments of pause in the bunch and taking those moments of opportunity where you can go. Luke Plapp is on the front once again. He is controlling this bunch again as he did yesterday. He's not letting this group, this breakaway group is too big to let go. They'd probably only let three riders up the road and let them stay away. Anything bigger than that, they're going to bring back very quickly.
It's hard to get away from anything if Luke Plapp has it in his mind that he wants to close things down. He's wearing shoes designed by his uncle. So too was at Georgia Baker throughout the women's race, designed by his uncle Cam Plapp, who's one of the local artists in Geelong. They've got a sign near the final corner, particularly in support of Georgia Baker. Now the counter-attacks start to come. So often the case, pretty quickly after an intermediate sprint, we see the attacks try and get themselves off the front. Everybody can anticipate them. It's a question of whether your legs are able to deliver the answer.
That's right. Usually the bunch drags out quite a lot before intermediate sprints, so you need to be in good position to capitalise on that. Otherwise, you just don't have a chance of jumping with any of those attacks.
One rider solo, the searching look underneath the arms, across the shoulder. He'd love some company. He can't survive for too long on his own. Not at this pace.
He's going to be swallowed up pretty quickly, but I don't think he's going to be too much of a threat. They're not going to drag him back immediately. Riders back in the bunch can save their legs and actually look more around them and see who else is going to try and jump across and attack as well.
Fergus Browning, number two in the white colours. Number 27, that's Zach Marriage. We now bridge across to the sole leader. In fact, there's one rider who is trying to go across. No, there's a rider that's off to the left that might have a mechanical problem who has been distanced. And this rider out in front is James Whelan, riding for the bike gallery near the train station in Camberwell. This is a big move by Jimmy Whelan. He was brilliant last year at the National Championships, second in the road race. He's just slipped away from World Tour level. It's Connor Sens who is trying to go across in the white colours, wearing the map kit. These two together could be threatening.
That's right. Jimmy Whelan is notably a great rider. It's a shame that he doesn't have a World Tour contract, because he's certainly capable of that level of racing, but that's sometimes the nature of that game. The contracts come and go pretty quickly, and sometimes you just have the wrong timing in your career. So it's great to see him still making the most of it. He had an amazing summer of cycling last year. It looks like he is showing his cards again, once again this year. So could be telling for some of the upcoming road racing that he is building towards, using these races as conditioning.
Great signs for James Whelan, one of the popular figures, particularly within the Melbourne cycling community. Developed a cult following after his first ever race in Europe was the under-23 Tour of Flanders, and he won it. What a way to get started in Europe.
You can't ask for a better result than that. The under-23 racing for the men is always a great draft for the World Tour teams. We don't have under-23 racing in the women yet, but it is coming. Slowly but surely, there will be an under-23 separate race at the World Championships in a couple of years' time, which is really important for the development of women's cycling. But for riders like James Whelan, they were able to use those Nations Cups, races such as the Tour of L'Avenir, to build towards their World Tour career. So for women, it's really great to see some of those opportunities finally coming as well.
Yeah, and at the under-23 World Championships also, it's been a long time coming, overdue, but thankfully we're getting there. Connor Sens is getting there as well, riding really strongly at the front. He spent a fair bit of his preparation doing the famous Sevens bunch ride in Bendigo, along with the likes of Peter Mullins. Chris the Hurricane Hamilton has been on that ride since returning to Australia in preparation for another big season for Chris Hamilton in 2023. Well, the challenge for the two riders out in front, Grace, is they don't have any teammates. So there's going to be plenty of people keen to chase them down.
That's right. They're in a tough position out there, but they're going to get dangled out there for quite a while, I'd say. But the good thing about having a breakaway of two or three riders is that you commit straight away and you don't really need to talk about it. They've jumped across, they're committed straight up. And as you can see with these two riders, they're riding as hard as they can sustain for the amount of time left in this race. They haven't really said many words to each other. They've just gone, let's go.
The gap continues to open up. Connor sends at the front, followed by James Whelan. They'll have a lot of support from the side of the road. Speed hump not slowing them down. Peloton going through at 20 seconds behind. Rough calculation. I've got the stopwatch, I think, as the leaders went across the finish line, but I've got that gap, Gracie, at 20 seconds. Give or take one or two.
It's not a lot, is it, Matt? It might look a lot because of the distance of this course, but 20 seconds can get taken down very quickly once the bunch wants to reel these two back in. But they're looking pretty strong out there. They're setting a really good pace. They're pulling pretty equal turns. They're in time trial mode. They're committed to making this work.
They're just under halfway through the race. They've been out there for 25 minutes. At 50 minutes having been covered, they'll get three laps remaining. Each lap is taking around about 2.5 minutes. So they're not quite halfway with an advantage of 20 seconds over the peloton. The bad news for them is that there's some big teams prepared to chase. A lot to like about the performance of James Whelan to bounce back, get himself into this sort of condition, ready to go for another big summer of cycling. Hoping, still hoping, that he can get the invite back into the World Tour.
It's a really tough position to be in because the riders that he's racing against, they're all full-time riders. They don't have to work a second job to sustain this kind of career. But when you've been dropped for that from that World Tour or Pro Continental level, you've also been dropped from a salary too. So that makes it a really difficult thing to justify the amount of training that you need to put in to be at this level. So it is commendable that he's still putting himself through that kind of effort, that those hours of training every week to stay involved in cycling, to keep trying to get those pro contracts.
And we saw the sort of speed that they had heading down the back straight alongside Corio Bay, almost 60 k's per hour. Connor Sands it is who is on the front. The wind is starting to pick up once again. The cool change has come through. Last time around, their advantage was roughly 20 seconds. A reaction coming from the peloton. It looked like one rider had gone clear solo from the main group. Not much communication required out in front. The little flick of the elbow, it's international. It's your turn now to come to the front and carve through the wind and give me some slipstream.
That's right. There's a bit of a body language. We can see Luke Plapp still driving it on the front. He's going to be setting a pace that he can sustain for quite a number of laps, but still have enough in the tank that he can bring that pace up when needed. But the riders out front here, they're not going to be talking too much to each other. They might be saying a few words of encouragement to keep them going, just letting each other know that they're committed. But that flick of the elbow, it's a way of saying my turn's up, but it's also a safety thing. Just in case that other rider is not concentrating or they're overlapping the wheel, it's good to just let them know that you're about to pull off so you don't crash each other, because that's the last thing that you want out there in a group of two.
The gap now, 25 seconds between the two leaders and the peloton being led by Luke Plapp. We also see, particularly when riders are in the peloton and they're climbing and they're about to get out of the saddle, they give the double flick of the elbow to let the rider behind them know they're about to get up out of the saddle, because the bike seems to jut back at you ever so slightly. So again, it's a safety measure and everybody looking after the others that are in the race.
That's right. There is a lot of communication that happens in the peloton, calling out potholes, corners, anything that could be a danger. Like you said, the double flick of the elbow if you're getting out of the saddle. You do have to learn as a cyclist not to throw your bike backwards behind you, but it still does move a little bit even if you've learnt not to do that. So it's just about being considerate of other riders. My pet peeve was when people did not go to the back of the bunch to blow their nose out. So that's my tip for anyone listening today. If you're in the bunch, in a bunch ride or in a race, that's a big no-no. And you will certainly get a bad reputation if you blow your nose in the middle of the bunch.
I think that's probably become even more pronounced in COVID times. On the back of that, we've been a lot more conscious of that.
Right. Yep.
This is Connor Sens. Hoping for a good summer for Connor Sens as well. He's getting off to a good start here at the Bay Crits. He was on the memorial ride a couple of weeks ago for Jason Lowndes, who tragically passed away 5 years ago. Great figure of Australian cycling and Bendigo cycling community, Jason Lowndes. He was sixth at the World Championships in Qatar in 2016. The gap now for the 2 litres, it looks like it's closing down. Last time through, it was 25 seconds. We could see the peloton rounding the corner. They are chasing, once again, the Bayside Citroën team. And the gap, 19 seconds as the whistle goes for the next of the intermediate sprints.
Keish have also put a rider up in that front chase as well. So we have a rider from Bayside Citroën on the front, rider from the Keish Park Up team as well, sitting behind. Even if they're not pulling as many turns as the Bayside Citroën team, just having a rider sitting in second spot shows the bunch we're also invested in bringing this back. It's about the message that you're sending sometimes when you have riders near the front or on the front of the bunch. And it also encourages other teams to go, okay, well, if you've got one rider in there, we'll put one rider in there too. And that's what really helps to bring back a breakaway. It's not just one team on the front, but that collaboration between teams to drag things back.
I wonder if these two will make it through to the finish line to collect the points in the race for the green jersey. Tom Chester, the leader of that classification, he missed out on points the last time through. He now has a 2-point advantage over Blake Quick, who is in the white colours of the Bayside Citroën team. Tom Chester, he was fourth, one spot away from picking up a point. Concentration on the face of James Whelan, out alongside Cario Bay once again.
It's looking a little overcast there. Hopefully it is cooling down for these riders. It's certainly going to make for a quicker race if it's cooler. Yesterday you could see the bunch just having those lulls just because everyone was suffering out there in the heat. It makes it slightly less aggressive when it's hot, but it also makes it less aggressive when you have a breakaway out in front, especially a small breakaway like this. And that's because the bunch behind doesn't see them as a big threat, therefore there's less attacks going. So sometimes the teams that do have a vested interest in winning the race or retaining the overall jerseys, this is their best situation.
This is the sprint for the points in the race for the green jersey. It's not a full-blooded sprint. Connor Sens leads them through. He picks up 3 points. Jimmy Whelan didn't challenge for the sprint points. He wants to maintain the cohesion. The sprint for the minor placings behind. Tom Chester in green. Can he get over the top and collect 1 point? He does. So Tom Chester picks up another point in the race for the green jersey.
That's fantastic to see that he's still got that interest in the green jersey and he's not giving up yet.
We'll wait for confirmation from that angle. There's lots of green jerseys out there, but certainly we saw Tom Chester just miss out on points the last time through. Connor Sens got maximum points. James Moriarty in second position getting 2 points. We'll wait for confirmation on third. The gap closed down ever so slightly for the 2 litres because of that sprint finish back in the peloton. The gap just on around about 15 seconds between the 2 litres and the rest of the main field.
They're taking all of the corners pretty nicely. It is nicer too when you're in a breakaway. It's safer. There's less riders around you doing things that you're not sure about. They're not being as unpredictable as it is in the bunch, but it's also you can go through corners quite a lot quicker as a smaller group too. And that's one of the things that helps them stay away. Whereas in the bunch, it does string out. The riders at the front for sure are going as quick or sometimes quicker than the two riders out in front, but the rest of the field behind is forming gaps. They're slowing down at the back. That concertina effect is happening. And that does have a bit of an impact overall on the bunch as a whole.
good news, Tom Chester, confirmation, he collected the 1 point. It was Tom who led the peloton across. So he now moves to seven. That gives him a 3 point lead on his nearest rival, Blake Quick. So Blake can win the next sprint and get 3 points, and then it will come down to a count back, which gives Blake a chance to get the green jersey. But Tom is keeping himself right in the hunt for the Mitchelton Wines green jersey. Well played.
That is well played. I'm very happy to see that. It's great to see a rider that is one out, doesn't have a team in this event, but a bit of a soft spot coming from Canberra, riding for Canberra sponsors. I'm very happy about that too. And I hope he gets to take home some nice Mitchelton wines, because I've had the pleasure of trying them many times over the years, and I can definitely give them the thumbs up.
They get the seal of approval from Gracie Elvin, and Tom Chester wants to get himself some too. James Whelan wants a stage victory. So too does Connor Sens. The gap is continuing to be reduced. And it's the white colours of Bayside Citroën, the teammates of the yellow jersey, Brenton Jones. Jones was brilliant yesterday. We hardly spotted him. He was camouflaged in white amongst his teammates. Today, he sticks out like a beacon in yellow. But he'll be wearing that jersey with pride. A big moment for Jones, this one, Gracie.
It really is. Even if he doesn't retain it after today, he would have just savoured every moment in that jersey. It's really special to wear the yellow jersey in one of your favourite events, but especially near at the end of your career. So we are hoping that he can go for another win today, but no doubt one of his teammates, it's going to either help him do it or take the win themselves.
No pressure here, Brenton. But he did say at the launch before Christmas that the Bay Crits would be his final elite race. Surely with this form, he goes 1 week longer and takes that condition to Sturt Street on the 6th of January to try and win the Criterium title again.
I'd say so. He's got a soft spot for that course as well. He has won the National Crit Championships in the past. He knows how to do it. So if you're on form like this, you've got that confidence. That's such a huge part of bike racing, is having that confidence. And the only way to get real confidence is to win bike races. And he did win one yesterday against some of the fastest riders in the country who will be also lining up at Sturt Street in less than a week's time.
I'd love to see Brenton Jones at those national championships. He was second twice, third once or twice, and then he finally won it. He did have some stiff competition when he got beaten, though. A guy called Caleb Ewan was pretty quick up Sturt Street.
Just a small guy. It's only Caleb Ewan.
Small guy with plenty of horsepower. Connor Sens has got a load of horsepower too. He's the man at the front. James Whelan from the Bike Gallery in Camberwell, right near the train station. He slotted himself in a second position, but he was the one who caused or forced this breakaway. And both these guys, they're not sprinters. For them to win, they need to make this courageous move of going off the front.
That's right. If you're not a pure sprinter, or if you're not in that designated lead-out train for a sprinter, your best opportunity is to get in a breakaway. For some riders, you don't even want to be in a big breakaway because you can't win a sprint from a group of 5 to 10 riders. So being in a solo or a breakaway of 2 or 3 riders is your best bet, especially if you have good time trialing abilities. James Whelan is known for his good climbing abilities, so he's got a really big engine, and an effort like this really suits him. But we can see 2 riders now trying to bridge the gap and jump across. It could be good for those 2 riders out in front in James Whelan and Sens, because they do need a couple more friends now that the pace is heating up. That gap is going to come down very quickly.
16 seconds the gap to the 2 chasers. 20 seconds is the gap to the peloton. So the gap between the 2 leaders and the peloton, it's been stable for the past 5 laps. They've been racing for 37 minutes. This race, a reminder for those of you tuning in for the first time, it is 50 minutes plus 3 laps. So they're almost, Gracie, getting to the point where they start to look to the clock and think, can we possibly hold on?
You're definitely looking at the clock now. Regardless of the heat out there, they're going pretty deep now. They've had a really good effort so far. If you were in training, you probably wouldn't want to be doing an effort any longer than this. Mentally, it's quite difficult, but when you're in a race situation, that mentality just switches. And when you have a friend out there, you're really pushing each other that little bit more. So being in a solo breakaway can be really difficult because it is such a mental effort as much as a physical effort. And when you've got a second rider out there, that you're just pushing each other and you're just getting those last extra watts out of each other. And I'd say they'd be starting to encourage each other even more now. You can see they're getting more aero, they're getting lower and lower, which means that they're trying to make the most of their watts, but it's also a bit of a tell that they're getting a bit more tired.
And I'm looking at the pedaling cadence. Jimmy Whelan looks to be pedalling at around about 10 revs per minute more than Connor Sense. He's on top of the gear and he's making the gear look light. Connor Sense is really muscling the gear over.
It is a difference in cadence for sure, Matt. Some people are just more comfortable at a lower cadence, but as well, it can also be a tell that they're getting more tired. So James Whelan does look very comfortable. He's got a nice cadence there. You do see that slightly higher cadence in riders that enjoy the climbs more than others. I'd say Connor Sense is less of a climber type and he's just trying to use his strength to get through this big effort that they're putting out there today.
There's no doubt that Jimmy Whelan is a fantastic climber. Almost 40 minutes of racing being covered. The C5X lead car, courtesy of Bayside European, makes its way through. Sharing the workload perfectly. Here comes the chase from behind. Four off the front together. Last time through, the gap was 16 seconds or so. A little indecision between these four. They're trying to get themselves organized, and the gap is still at roughly 16, 17 seconds. Back to the peloton, and the chase is being led by Team Bridge Lane. The gap to the peloton, 27 seconds. In fact, that looks like ARA Skip Capital on the front. Such similar looking colours between those two teams. This is Daryl Margrate at the back for Novotel Prestige Jayco. It's been a pretty tough journey for Daryl over the past few years. He's had a rare disease to try and deal with. He's a qualified physiotherapist. He managed to get those qualifications in the last couple of years. He's become a father in the past 7 years as well. It's been a real family affair for him to get his health back and back into racing at the top end of the National Road Series. And he was really looking forward to getting amongst it and testing himself against some of the best from Australian cycling that race on the World Tour. And he's proven it, that he's right up to the task.
Yes, this is a really good move. It's really great to see four riders jumping across. It was only two originally, and it maybe was not quite enough to jump that gap. But having four there, they'll be able to have a really good working group there to try and get across to these two. There was also another Novotel Bayside Prestige rider there in Ben Hill. So that'll be interesting in the dynamic in that breakaway then, to have two riders from the same team.
And there he is at number nine. That is Ben Hill from the Novotel team. Number 23, that's James Moriarty. Good move for James Moriarty. The next intermediate sprint, that is still to come. Moriarty started 3 points behind Tim Chester in the race for green. He's now 4 points behind him, but if he can pick up maximum points on the final intermediate sprint, which is still about 5 minutes away, that's a chance for him to move towards the top and challenge for the jersey tomorrow. Looks like Daryl is just about to lose contact at the back of this group to turn it from four to three. And the reaction coming in front. James Whelan and Connor Sense, they know the chase is on from behind and they are persevering well.
It's Jack Aitken in there as well. He was one of the aggressors yesterday, so he's definitely got some interest in keeping a breakaway going today. This is a nice group of three riders. They have quite a good chance of jumping across to those front two. And the bunch is quite a way behind. I'd be interested to see who else is trying to jump across. It looks like a lone rider also trying to get across to this group.
Well, 15 seconds, the gap to the chasers behind the two leaders. The peloton, still some indecision. They find themselves at 32 seconds behind the two leaders. 41 minutes down. This is a race of 50 minutes plus three laps. They're going to take some chasing, these two. And the Bayside Citroën team will need to get organised to close it down. The good news for Brenton Jones is the two riders out in front didn't pick up any points yesterday. So in the bid for the final yellow jersey, it's not all lost if they don't catch these two.
That's right. It's not like a road tour where it's based on time that's accumulated over the course of stages. This is a points-based series, so it doesn't matter the points what set that separate those top 10 riders. And these riders, as you say, they weren't in the points yesterday, so they're not as much of a threat. They don't really want to give the stage away, though. They still want to get the stage win, but it's not the biggest threat to the overall yellow jersey.
no protection along Corio Bay. But the good news for the riders in the men's race is that the weather conditions have eased significantly by comparison to what they were in the women's race. They had the hotter part of the day and they had a lot more wind. Connor Sens at the front. James Whelan, he does look the more comfortable of the two, but Connor Sens doesn't look as if he's about to blow up by any stretch of the imagination, still moving strongly at the front.
It looks like they're both very much still riding within themselves. I wouldn't be surprised if we see a late attack by James Whelan, though. He looks like he is the stronger of the two. Maybe he just goes, I can go a bit faster on my own. I'm just going to try that instead. But I think you want to stay together as long as possible.
Conditions locally been classified almost as a bit chilly, certainly in contrast to what it was yesterday and earlier this afternoon. Jimmy Whelan leads them through. They'll be starting to look across to see when the lap board comes out. They've been racing now for 44 minutes. It's 50 minutes plus three laps. The gap to the chasers last time around was 16 seconds. This time it is 13 seconds. So the chasers are closing in gradually.
The chasers, they've certainly got the numbers advantage. They've got 3 versus 2, but these two have been out for a lot longer. So those three chasing behind are a little bit fresher. They've got the likes of Ben Hill as well, who is a very good time trial, especially now he's training for triathlon.
And now a change at the front. It is 34 seconds and the whistle has gone for the third and final intermediate sprint. 34 seconds to the peloton and Bayside Citroën, the team of Brenton Jones, the yellow jersey, they've taken up the chase.
They've taken up the chase very seriously. Yesterday, they only had Luke Plapp and Fergus Browning on the front. They could handle things pretty well just between the two of them, but it looks like they've got the whole team now on the front. They want to make the most of this race. They want to be greedy and take all of the stages. So they've got everyone working hard to bring back all of the riders that are up the road ahead of the main peloton.
Well, there's still more than 10 minutes of racing to go, probably closer to 15 minutes of racing remaining. The gap between the peloton and the two leaders, 34 seconds. A brief look across the shoulder from Connor Sens, number 47. A word of encouragement to Jimmy Whelan. These two, they don't wear the same jersey, but they're racing like teammates now, racing for their survival.
You definitely become teammates when you're in that breakaway situation, particularly when there's only two of you out there. There's a real shared suffering, so they'll probably have a good laugh about it after this race is over. But they're doing very well now. They're maintaining quite a good gap. The bunch is definitely bringing them back, but they're putting in everything they can now. They're definitely riding on their threshold. But as I was saying, it looks like James Whelan is taking it a little bit easier than Connor Sens. I think Sens is starting to suffer a little bit. And I wouldn't be surprised if we see an attack from James.
It's Connor Sens in the map kit who is about to lead them through the left-hand turn. He won the previous intermediate sprint, but it wasn't a contest as such. It was about maintaining their rhythm. It looks like a little bit more of a serious sprint now. Connor Sens wants to make sure that he gets maximum points. And this moves Connor into second position in the race for the green jersey. So even if they don't hold on to win the stage, Connor is still in with a chance to win the final green jersey at the end of racing tomorrow. Smart riding by Connor Sens. And the gap to the chasers, 13 seconds. Ben Hill leads them across.
These chasers are working pretty hard. It is smart riding by Connor Sens to try and keep maintaining those points in the green jersey classification, but he did put in a bit of an effort, and I think because he's already suffering a bit, you just don't want to be putting in those extra little power bursts, because a rider like James Whelan will take advantage of that and try and break away potentially later in this race. But the Bayside Citroën team, they're driving it on the front now, aren't they, Matt?
Big Cam Rogers takes over the pacemaking. It was Aidan Buttigieg before him. Last time through, the gap to the peloton was 34 seconds. This time, it's 32 seconds. They didn't take much time back at all, Gracie.
No, that's really interesting because it looks like they're working very hard on the front now, and the riders out in front are maintaining the gap quite well. So it means that these two riders, they have saved a little bit in the tank. They were working so well together right from the moment they joined forces. But they've saved enough to just keep bringing that pace up a little bit. And that's a bit of a trick in a breakaway situation. You want to get the gap going as quick as you can and go quite hard quite early. But you also need to leave a bit in the tank because you know that the peloton will increase the pace eventually. And you need to match that increase in pace as much as you can.
Well, the gap to the three chase is stuck in the middle with Ben Hill leading them through for the intermediate sprint. They've been pegged at around that 14-15 second mark for the last few laps. These two won't be waiting for anyone. They want to dispute the stage finish between the two of them. James Whelan in second spot, riding the colours of the bike gallery. In the map colours at the front is Connor Senn. So local Melbourne bike shop, Melbourne produced or started company for the clothes with MAP at the front. Neither of these guys with a team within the race, and they're upstaging some of the big names.
That's one of the beauties of cycling, when you see some of the underdogs try and take their chances in the racing, and these two are certainly trying their chances in the Citroën Bay Crits series. You've got to try everything you can. You've got to know what your strengths are and play with them and use them to the advantage and race against the bunch, against all of those sprinting teams that are working hard to try and pull these five riders back.
Jack Aiken in the red colours. He did actually just get over the top of Ben Hill as they went through that intermediate sprint to collect the 1 point. The gap now closing significantly as the chase is on from behind. Fergus Browning doing the pacemaking. It's getting serious for the boys in the white colours from Bayside Citroën down towards the business end of the race. Almost 50 minutes having been raced. When they come through next time, they'll get the lap board indicating three laps to go. Can they survive?
It's going to be close, Matt. I think that these riders have done a really great job today. I do think it's going to come down to a sprint finish, but the bunch has its work cut out for them. You could see through that finish zone, the Bayside Citroën team really putting down the power there with their riders out on front. But I think that Luke Plapp has got plenty up his sleeve. He's going to be the next cab off the rank, and he's going to bring this gap down quite a lot.
You know, Luke Plapp can do a lot of damage in the space of just one lap. He's got the horsepower of a man who represented Australia at the Tokyo Olympics in the team pursuit 4 kilometres, which takes them less than 3 minutes and 50 seconds. They blister through those 4Ks. And having the speeds in the pursuit, the individual and the team pursuit, improved remarkably in the last few years. Another sneaky look across the shoulder from Connor Senn. And it's a long way down that straight. At these speeds, it's a lot of distance that gets covered. They're doing 55 Ks per hour down this back straight.
And that's why you don't see the gap come down too much on those straights where they're holding that high speed, because you just can't ride that much faster than 55 or 60 k an hour, even in the bunch. So they're able to maintain a good gap because of the nature of this course, which is quite interesting. They're really using this uphill drag and kicker with their climbing strength, and then the other fast parts of the course, the physics of it just mean that the bunch doesn't quite catch up and up quick enough anyway. And the three chasing behind have not been able to cover much ground at all. These two riders out in front are having a really strong day.
Number 52, James Whelan at the back, riding a much smaller gear than Connor Senn, pedaling his way convincingly on the uphill drag towards the finish line. But here comes the peloton. Jack Aiken at the front. He's just about been reeled back in. ARA Skip Capital getting involved in the chase to see if they can go a few spots better than yesterday. They had third, fourth, and fifth. They're getting themselves organized for a sprint finish on stage two. The yellow jersey has slotted himself onto the wheel of Graham Frizzly. He knows who his big rival is.
Team Bridge Lane have also got a lot of numbers up there in the front. They're riding for Nick White, number 30. He was 10th yesterday. I'd say that they want to get him into a podium spot. He's capable of that kind of result, so they would have been disappointed with yesterday. But this is going to be a good drag race between the Bayside Citroën team, the ARA Skip Capital team, and Team Bridge Lane. I think we've got a good sprint on our hands coming up.
And we're down to the final three laps. The two leaders, at one point, they're out to an advantage of 34 seconds. How quickly that can be reduced. Regardless of the outcome for James Whelan and Connor Senn, they've marked themselves as men to watch, particularly for the national championships in Ballarat and Buninyong. I think James Whelan is a real contender for the national title.
I'm really looking forward to watching him in the road race, but he's done a great job today. I think he can walk away pretty proud with his efforts today, but I think he's going to be happy just with the conditioning effort going into next weekend.
And the teams of the sprinters spoiling the day for the breakaway. James Whelan this time charging down the back straight. Connor Senn takes over once again. And in second spot, Luke Plapp, wearing the colours of Ineos Grenadiers, waiting to launch himself at the front, where he will just continue to open up the throttle and stretch the peloton out.
I'm sure Luke Plapp is happy with a bit of help from some other teams there, but he certainly is going to bring down this gap quite a lot by the time that he gets on the front. But the team Bridge Lane has done a great effort to bring the gap down considerably. The Keisha Park Up team have some good vested interests, especially with their sprinter Graham Frizzley, who was second yesterday. I think that they would also like to get organized. They need to get together. They're a bit all over the place compared to some of the other teams. They're going to have to get a bit more organized in the last couple of laps.
The yellow jersey is on the wheel of Blake Quick. Simon Clark is also towards the front. He did a 152-kilometre training ride this morning. James Whelan in the colours, the grey colours of the bike gallery, followed by Connor Sens. Two laps remaining. The lead out is from ARA Skip Capital. They're looking for Angeluto and Wiggins to get the job done for them.
It does look like the Keisha Park Up team are getting organised on the right-hand side of the bunch there. They've got three riders in behind Team Bridge Lane. The Bayside Citroën team are also collecting a little bit together, but they've had to use a lot of their manpower today to try and bring the breakaway back. So yellow jersey wearer Brenton Jones is going to need Blake Quick as much as possible in this last lap and a half because they've had to use up all of their men already.
What a handy card to play, though. Blake Quick won the series last year with Brenton Jones as his lead out man. This time around, he is returning the favour, but they still have not caught the two leaders. A lap and a half remaining. James Whelan and Connor Sens. They really have taken this race by the scruff of the neck, but they're about to shake the last drops of energy out of their legs as it's Luke Plapp towards the front, about to take over the pacemaking on the peloton. He sits in second spot.
I'd say this is the last moments that these two riders in James Whelan and Connor Sens are going to be out. They've got that speed on the bottom end of this back straight, but as soon as the road starts kicking up, I think that's going to see the end of this gap. They're probably going to be caught not too close to the finish line going in that last lap to go.
And there's a real fight for the position behind the yellow jersey. Next attack comes. And it's the green colours of the Cachet Park Up team. They've got Graham Frizzley. Graham Frizzley is fighting for that spot behind Brenton Jones. The breakaway of Whelan and Sens has now been caught. It was brave, but it didn't quite work out. They go through this corner for the penultimate time. They'll head through the finish line and they'll get the bell.
It did look like an ARA Skip Capital rider making the charge up. No, it's Simon Clark, followed by Cam Ivory wearing the National Crit Champs jersey. This is a very interesting breakaway. They're actually riding for the same team in the Novotel Bayside Prestige team. You do not want to let those two riders up the road with only one lap to go.
They get the bell. It's Plapp who was doing the chasing. The Australian road champion chasing the Australian criterium champion and one of the stars of Australian cycling, Simon Clark. Novotel Prestige Jayco, two teammates out in front being chased by Bayside Citroën as it is Plapp doing the job for Jones. Clark, he's already got more than 150 Ks in the legs. Nice warm-up for this afternoon's race.
He loves the long rides, that's for sure, but he is working towards some bigger races, bigger goals this year. But that was a beautifully timed attack by these two riders out in front. As soon as the breakaway of Whelan and Sens was caught, they just went straight onto the attack, following the attack by the Keisha Park Up rider, going straight over the top. It looks like Simon Clark is just going for it.
He is. Clark goes clear. And now Cameron Ivory, he can cause a few problems here for the chase from behind by going slower than he needs to through the corner, but they weren't quite on him. A 50-metre or so, it's just a long drop punt, the advantage for Simon Clark ahead of Plapp. And then it is ARA Skip Capital lining up to try and get the stage victory for Wiggins. Craig Wiggins from WA. He's followed then the white jersey by Blake Quick. It is then Jones in yellow and then Graham Frizzley. Clark has been caught.
Clark has been caught. It was just not quite enough, but it was a great effort by Clark and Ivory to try and get the surprise on the bunch. It looks like Team Bridge Lane have done a really good job in getting themselves set up, but the ARA Skip Capital have come up fast on the left, racing for Craig Wiggins, but the yellow jersey is covering everything with his teammate in Blake Quick, who's got those bright blue nicks on. This is a fantastic drag race up to that final corner.
Okay, Craig Richards at the front, followed by Craig Wiggins. There goes Graham Frizzly, number 21. Jones squeezes through the middle. The foot comes out. Wiggins opens up the sprint. Frizzly is trying to challenge. Can Wiggins hold on? Graham gets the frizzle and gets the job done. A win for Graham Frizzly, and he'll move into the yellow jersey.
That was an exciting corner. I was on the edge of my seat. The road looked quite slippery on that final corner. I was wondering if there was going to be a crash. They were really just diving into it, taking every different line possible. Brenton Jones did a good job, but I think he was just a bit too tight on the inside and wasn't able to maintain that momentum. The Cage Park Up team did a really great job in setting up Graham Frizzly, and the ARA Skip Capital team also did a very good job in setting up Craig Wiggins, but he just could not overcome in that final few metres.
Fantastic performance by Graham Frizzly. How much tension was there in that final corner? Jones, as you mentioned, he lost all momentum. The foot came out as he tries to squeeze through the middle, and he pays a heavy price because we'll wait for confirmation on the final placings across the line, but Frizzly, after finishing in second spot yesterday, is going to take a handy lead into the final stage tomorrow.
Yes, this series has really heated up on the second day. I think the bunch really had their sights setting on working over the Bayside Citroën team, the dream team as it were, but they were able to isolate some of these riders, especially Blake Quick and Brenton Jones in that final.
So by my calculations, Graham Frizzly will head into tomorrow's stage on 22 points, Brenton Jones on 18 points, Craig Wiggins on 17 points. It's still tight, but a real battle between those top three.
It will be a great battle. Unfortunately, Brenton Jones won't be able to wear that yellow jersey on the final day as he got to wear it today, but I think he still would have really enjoyed wearing it. We can see the replay now of the sprint.
And Blake Angelotto in third spot. So ARA Skip Capital. And in fourth position, Kurt Ether celebrating his teammate's victory. Jones, bitterly disappointed. Understandably so.
You can see how important that final corner was in that two teams had two riders coming in quite close together. So they were really working hard to get into a good position into that final corner to maintain that momentum. And that meant that Agnoletto was able to claim third spot and Kurt Ether was able to claim fourth spot as well. So it's interesting how that happens when you have such close lead outs in a tricky finale like that.
Oh, looking forward to hearing from Graham Frizzly. He was close yesterday, and today he gets the victory. Recently crowned the Australian Madison champion. We've spoken a lot about that balance between the track and the road, and actually feed off each other really well. We're seeing at the moment, particularly cyclocross, with the big three there in both the men's and the women's. But in Australia, it's been a lot about juggling the track and the road, and Frizzly is another example of it.
Well, they've got some great speed in their legs from some of the track competitions that they've done in the last couple of months. There's not a lot of road racing going into the summer of cycling, so that's why you get so nervous for the Bay Crits, because you're not quite sure how you're going to go. But for those riders that juggle the track as well, they did know where their form's at. They've got that little bit of extra confidence, and that's why that they take those extra risks going into the finals, because they know what they've got to win big races like this.
Sprinters are natural-born risk-takers, aren't they?
That's for sure. There's definitely a saying, and you've got to be prepared to crash if you want to win. So that's not a great way to look at it. But ultimately, that's kind of what sprinting is like. It is quite dangerous. But just look at the power of these guys. It's a really tough finish. That really sharp left-hand corner kicks up, but it also keeps dragging all the way to the finish line. So just maintaining that power is really important.
You could see that moment with roughly 50 metres to go where Wiggins looked to his right. And you could see the power go out of his legs as Frizzly made his way by. Wiggins knew at that point he didn't have enough petrol tickets to get there.
That's right. I think it's hard not to look around if you're not leading. If you're leading, you think you're going to win the race, and suddenly someone comes past you, it's pretty demoralizing. But if you're the one that can't quite make it and match that speed of the rider that is about to cross the line first, it's really tough to not just let your legs go a little bit, and you could just see that happening.
So the points classification now for the race for the yellow jersey, Graham Frizzly is on 22 points. Brenton Jones is on 18. So it's a 4-point gap between the two of them. 12 points to win, 10 points for second place, 8 points for third place. It's a pretty simple scenario tomorrow for Jones. Win and just hope that Graham Frizzley finishes outside the top three. And if he finishes third, it goes to a count back and then Brenton Jones will win because he's won two stages.
That's right. I think it's going to be very tight tomorrow, and it's going to come down to experience and who's raced on that Ritchie Boulevard course more than once. I think it's a hot dog course, but it's about positioning and it's about teamwork as well. So that Bayside Citroën team is really going to have to come together like they have in the last 2 days. And I'd say that Luke Plapp has got another big session ahead of him to try and hold that pace super high so they can control it.
It's a really tough course tomorrow. And Brenton Jones has been successful on that course in the past. He's had plenty of top three finishes on that course. But I think Graham Frizzley will fancy himself on the course because he is small in physical stature, big in horsepower. He can get through those corners really well. But Brenton Jones, for a guy who's more than 6 foot tall and weighs about 80 kilos, he corners like he's a Valentino Rossi on a push bike.
Yeah, it certainly comes down to a bit of physics on that course. Being smaller does help because of such tight hot dog corners. But Brenton Jones is a seasoned professional. He has done well on that course before. And this is it. This is one of his big final races. And I think he's just going to try and leave it all out there. He's not risking it for any bigger races coming up in Europe. He's just going to put it all on the line.
Well, we're not too far away from hearing from Graham Frizzley, catching up with David McKenzie. David McKenzie's had plenty of success himself at the Bay Crits in the past, and he's getting to do our pre- and post-race interviews. I'm sure he's enjoying it on the more comfortable side of the fence, but this was a series where Macca thrived in the past. Really good rides today by James Whelan and Connor Senns. We're seeing Connor Senns just work his way back through the finish line. He put in a good performance to get himself close to the green jersey in the race for the points classification, but not quite in the lead. Tom Chester, I think, has done enough to hold on to that classification by 1 point. He has. It's Tom Chester who's on 7 points in the race for green. Connor Senns is in second place on 6 points. So a tight battle there too tomorrow, Gracie.
It is a tight battle, but I think we're going to see a different dynamic play out tomorrow when it comes to the green jersey. It's going to be raced super hard tomorrow because of this overall tight points in the overall yellow jersey. So I think that there's going to be a lot less rope given to riders that want to go for that green jersey and those points. It's going to be survival mode for many riders just to even finish the race.
The red hat with the garbage bag and starting to collect all the barricades and so on and picking up the rubbish. Chris Jones, the father of Brenton Jones, we've spoken about this being a family affair. He does all the barricades. Mum is at the top of the food chain getting things organised. Jared Jones, the brother, is out there as well doing neutral service. And we've got the third generation coming through as well with Jared's son. Here's Graham Frizzley, the winner of the stage.
No, I don't need to. Graham, well done. Great win. Great win for the new team, new sponsors. You've got to be happy about that.
Oh, yeah, definitely. It's always...
Talk wasn't about yourself or you guys. You had a great ride yesterday, but it was more about Jones, Blake Quick. But you delivered and you didn't just beat them today. You got them. It was a resounding win.
Yeah, well, I think there was a bit of an incident on the last corner with BJ. He had to unclip, so that's why he wasn't really there in the finish. But no, I was happy with yesterday. I was very pleasantly surprised after coming back from Tassie Carnivals. And then, yeah, but I was feeling pretty good this morning, so I know I'd probably have a good one today.
You've had a good one, and you've put yourself in the yellow jersey with a day to go. So let's quickly talk about that. Ritchie Boulevard, a hot dog.
Yeah, well, I wasn't even planning to race tomorrow, to be honest. Wanted to have at least a few days off before Road Nats, but looks like I got a line up now. But no, it should be, it's always a bit of a hard one. I'm sure the boys won't make it easy for me either, but no, I should have a decent day out.
Good stuff. Well done today. Good luck tomorrow.
Cheers. Thanks.
Well, it's going to be a big battle on his hands tomorrow. He knows it's tight. He's got a big smile on his face, but it will be a picture of concentration tomorrow. We've seen him race at the back of the peloton a lot. He won't be able to do that tomorrow, Gracie.
No, he said that he wasn't even going to race tomorrow, so that's kind of funny. I think a lot of riders do that and have done over the years with the Bay Crits. Just pick one or two races if you don't want to go for the overall because it's dangerous. You're risking crashing before nationals or other big goals that you have. But he seems pretty relaxed. He seems really happy. And to wear the yellow jersey, you know, it's pretty cool. But it's also a respectful thing to do for the bunch too, to show up and race your best tomorrow. But I think no matter what day the Ritchie Boulevard course is on, it used to be on the first day for me, I think even on the third day, they're going to be nervous. It's a tough course. It's tricky. It's dangerous. And it's going to be super hard. As you said, the boys, he meant the other teams are not going to make it very easy for him. So I think it's going to be a great one to watch.
If you're anywhere near Geelong, I can recommend getting down to Ritchie Boulevard to watch it. It is like the perfect viewing stadium for a criterium. You're up on the hill over Cryo Bay and you can see them the whole way around. If not, you can join Gracie Alvin and me, Matt Keenan, tomorrow just before 6 o'clock Australian Eastern Daylight Saving Time for the final stage of the Citroën Bay Crits. Ruby Rose Bengannon, she has an unassailable lead in the race for the women's competition. But in the men's, it's tight. It's Frizzly, it is Jones or Angelotto. Join us tomorrow to find out who takes home yellow. Gotta dream about it. Gotta find a way to do the things that make you feel alone. Gotta think about it. Gotta dream about it. Gotta find a way to do the things that make you feel alone.
Breathe in, breathe out. Here, you're surrounded by silence. You feel in total harmony with your movement, with the world. Here, you simply feel serene, at peace.
All new Citroën C5X.
The spirited traveller eagerly anticipates the sea of possibilities that new adventures bring. The unwritten paths, unexpected journeys, and unforgettable memories that lay just beyond the horizon. Discover Spirit of Tasmania Key Geelong, where a new adventure begins. Be a spirited traveller.